의 취향. 미니, 변현재, 프로토스, 라바, 임홍규, 저그. ASL 시즌 11 파이널.
하식스와 LG 울트라기어가 함께하는 ASL 시즌 11, ASL이라는 이름으로 펼쳐지는 첫 프로토스와 저그의 결승전 프리뷰로 인사드립니다. 안녕하세요, 이영경입니다. 3월 28일 봄비와 함께 개막한 ASL 시즌 11, 치열한 경쟁을 통해서 살아남은 선수는 두 선수인데요. 생애 첫 우승이라는 같은 목표를 가지고 만난 부산연설 동갑내기 프로토스 변현재 선수와 저그 임홍규 선수가 바로 그 주인공입니다. 자, 이 두 선수 이번 시즌 어떤 과정을 거쳐 이 무대까지 올라오게 됐는지 그 과정을 저와 함께 살펴보시죠. 자, 먼저 변현재 선수는 24강 마지막 F조에 속해 첫 경기 배호연 선수를 무자비하게 잡아냈는데요. 승자전에서 윤찬희 선수에게 일격을 맞았습니다. 이후 펼쳐진 한두열 선수와의 경기에서도 시작은 좋지 않았지만 특유의 적극적 강점을 내세우면서 승리를 거두고 16강에 올라갔습니다. 16강에서는 A조에 속해 김윤중 선수를 잡아내고 승자전에서 디펜딩 챔피언 김명훈 선수마저 잡아내면서 8강에 올라왔는데요. 8강에서는 도재욱 선수를 만나 그야말로 무자비한 모습으로 승리를 거두고 4시즌 만에 4강에 올라왔습니다. 4강에서는 다시 한번 디펜딩 챔피언 김명훈 선수를 만나서 압도적인 모습을 보여주면서 ASL 시즌 7 이후 4시즌 만에 결승 진출에 성공했습니다. 반면 임홍규 선수는 16강을 시드로 시작했는데요. 본인의 천적이라 여겨지던 김태경 선수를 직접 데려와 승리를 거두고 승자전에서 장윤철 선수까지 잡아냈습니다. 자, 이후 8강에서 만난 임홍규 선수의 상대는 바로 유영진 선수였는데요. 한 세트씩 주고받는 치열한 접전 끝에 3대2 어려운 승리를 거두고 4강에 올라왔습니다. 4강에서 만난 조일장 선수, 본인의 약점이라 여겨지던 저그전 다전제를 완벽하게 극복해내는 모습을 보여주면서 생애 첫 결승 진출에 성공했습니다. 자, 이 두 선수가 우승하게 된다면 만들어지는 기록들에 대해서도 확인해 보겠습니다. 자, 먼저 변현재 선수가 승리를 거두게 된다면 생애 첫 우승에 성공하게 되는데요. 프로토스는 ASL 시즌5 정윤종 선수의 우승 이후 6시즌 만에 약 3년여 만에 우승자를 배출해내게 됩니다. 자, 그리고 시즌1의 김윤중 선수와 시즌5 정윤종 선수 이후 세 번째 프로토스 우승자의 타이틀을 거머쥘 수 있게 됩니다. 자, 반면 임홍규 선수가 우승을 차지하게 된다면 역시 생애 첫 우승을 차지하게 되는데요. 저그는 ASL 시즌9과 시즌10에 이어 세 시즌 연속 저그 우승자를 배출해내게 됩니다. 자, 그리고 ASL 내에서는 우승한 저그인 김정우 선수, 김명훈 선수에 이어서 세 번째 저그 우승자의 타이틀을 거머쥐게 됩니다. 자, 그렇다면 여기서 잠시 역대 ASL 우승자들의 면모를 저와 함께 살펴보실까요? 전신인 대국민 스타리그를 포함해 ASL 시즌10까지 총 11번의 시즌에서 이영호 선수가 4회 우승을 차지하며 단연 최강의 자리에 올라있고 그 뒤를 2명의 저그 김정우 선수와 김명훈 선수가 따르고 있으며 김윤중, 정윤종 그리고 김성현 선수가 각각 1회 우승을 차지했습니다. 과연 ASL의 7번째 챔피언은 누가 될지 많은 기대를 보내주시기 바랍니다. 자, 이어서 양 선수의 상대 전적도 살펴볼까요? 자, 양 선수는 ASL 시즌5 8강에서 처음 만났고 당시 변현재 선수가 3대0으로 승리하며 시드를 얻은 경험이 있었죠. 자, 그리고 이후 ASL 시즌7에서 16강에서는 먼저 임홍규 선수가 승리했지만 이어진 최종전 경기에서 변현재 선수가 승리하며 8강 진출에 성공했고 다음 시즌이었던 ASL 시즌8 16강에서는 임홍규 선수가 승리를 거두면서 양 선수의 합산 상대 전적은 4대2로 변현재 선수가 다소 앞서 있는 상황입니다. 자, 그렇다면 양 선수의 경기를 지켜보는 시청자 여러분들은 어떤 예상을 보내주고 계셨을까요? 방금 전인 7시까지 아프리카 TV ASL 공식 방송국에서 설문한 결과 56%의 팬 여러분이 변현재 선수의 우승을 예상하고 계셨습니다. 역시 변현재 선수가 다전제에서 보여줬던 저그전 능력이 뛰어났기 때문에 이런 결과가 나타났다는 생각이 드는데요. 이러한 예측대로 변현재 선수가 우승을 차지하게 될지 아니면 임홍규 선수가 첫 결승에서 우승까지 차지할지 궁금해집니다. 자, 이어서 ASL 시즌 11 함께했던 16강 선수들에게 물어본 결과까지 확인해 보겠습니다. 결승 진출자인 두 선수를 제외한 14명의 선수들 중 김윤중, 조기석, 도재욱, 김정우, 장윤철, 유영진 그리고 이재호 7명의 선수들이 변현재 선수의 우승을 예상했고요. 조일장 김명훈, 윤찬희, 정영재, 박상현, 김지성 그리고 김태경 역시 7명의 선수들이 이몽규 선수의 우승을 예상하고 있었습니다. ASL 시즌 11 결승전 역시 정말 예측 불허의 승부가 펼쳐질 것 같은데요. 과연 오늘의 주인공은 누가 될지 끝까지 함께해 주시기 바랍니다. 하식스와 LG 울트라기어가 함께하는 ASL 시즌 11 생애 첫 우승을 노리는 1994년 프로토스 변현재 선수와 이몽규 선수의 경기. 과연 어떤 선수가 마지막 무대에서 웃을 수 있을지 ASL 시즌 11 대망의 결승전 무대를 지금 시작하겠습니다.
시즌 11 대망 결승전 대결 11년 동안 이 무대를 준비한 두 선수의 대결이 펼쳐지겠습니다. 2010년 같은 해 선수로 데뷔를 하고 걸어온 이 역사를 만들기 위해서 정말 많은 노력을 한 두 명의 선수죠. 프로토스의 전설이 되기 위한 변현재, 그리고 11년간 도전 끝에 최고의 자리에 올라서기 위한 준비가 끝난 이몽규 선수, 두 선수와 이야기를 나눠보도록 하겠습니다. 먼저 변현재 선수.
네.
11년 만에 우승 트로피를 들어올릴 수 있는 최적의 기회, 지난 시즌 최정상의 자리에 김명훈 선수 제압하고 이제 올라와서 보니까 변현재 선수와 시작은 동일하지만 걸어온 길이 달랐던 이몽규 우승 생각하고 계시죠?
솔직히 이제 4강에서 최고로 잘하는 선수를 꺾었다고 생각하기 때문에
오!
솔직히 결승은 4강보다는 쉽다라고 생각을 하고
야! 웃음이 날 정도로?
그 정도는 아니지만
네.
그래도 이제 최근에 ASL에서 오! 제일 잘하는 선수를 꺾었다고 생각하기 때문에
와!
자신감이 좀 있는 것 같아요.
그렇다면 그 위대한 김명훈 선수와 이몽규 선수는 어떤 부분이 그렇게 달라요? 뭐가 다르죠? 지략, 피지컬, 운영 능력?
솔직히 김명훈 선수가 좀 노련하다고 생각하거든요.
오!
근데 이제 노련한 선수도 이제 저한테 속수무책으로 다했기 때문에 이몽규 선수도 좀 많이 당황하지 않을까 싶어요.
와! 이몽규! 무난한 김명훈보다도 실력이 떨어진다는 얘기는 허점이 많다! 하자가 많은 조그다! 어떻게 생각하세요?
노련만 했기 때문에 김명훈 선수가 졌다라고 생각을 하고요.
네,
저는 오늘 조금 다른 모습을 보여주려고 이 자리에
네.
나왔기 때문에 네, 문제 없을 거라고 생각합니다.
변현재 선수는 상대방의 움직임도 보지도 않고 그냥 15분 컷! 그 전에 컷! 정말 멋진 빌드를 짜가지고 나왔는데요. 그런 부분에 있어서 이몽규 선수 어떤 준비를 하셨습니까?
뭐 대체적으로 고루고루 다 준비를 했고요. 뭐 예전 같은 경우는 방송할 때 하루 정도 텀만 두고 연습을 준비를 했다면 이번에는 정말 장기간에 걸쳐가지고 다방면으로 다 준비를 했기 때문에 예, 뭐 초반에 변현재 선수가 강력하다 할지라도 딱히 무섭지가 않습니다.
와! 그렇다면 변현재는 초반만 잘하는 프로토스다?
어떻게 보면 그렇다라고 말할 수 있겠죠.
그럼 첫 끝발이?
예?
예. 그러면 다른 선수들과의 또 이제 비교를 해본 결과 변현재 선수는 프로토스 중에서 얼마나 더 까다로운 선수고 또 어떻게 파야 되는지 분석이 끝난 거예요?
네, 뭐 가장 까다롭다고 생각이 들 수도 있겠지만
네.
어떻게 보면은 가장 또 그게 단순한 거거든요. 까다롭게만 할 줄 알기 때문에 네, 그 점을 좀 이용할 계획입니다.
와! 까다롭기만 한 프로토스다. 여기서 완전히 이몽규 선수는 지금 승리에 있어서 확신이 있어요. 준비가 된 모든 게 있고 변현재 선수에 대한 분석이 좀 끝난 것 같은데요. 웃어요. 웃고 있습니다. 지금 이몽규 선수가 까다롭기만 한 선수가 이길 수 있다라는데 왜 웃으세요? 웃겨요?
아니 뭐 홍규가 뭐 이제 대회에서 저한테 자전제에서 크게 한번 당해봤잖아요. 그렇기 때문에 이제 좀 자신감이 좀 넘치고 이제 그 당황스러움이 이제 대회에서 느껴지면 좀 크게 느껴지거든요.
야!
이제 온라인에서 연습할 때보다 이제 대회에서의 당황함이 더 크다고 느끼기 때문에
네.
지금은 저렇게 자신 있어 할지 몰라도 좀 경기 내에서는 좀 많이 다를 거라고 생각합니다.
이게 말과 실전은 다르다.
네.
이몽규 선수는 말뿐인 적이다. 지금 변현재 선수가 이렇게 자신감 넘치게 인터뷰한 적 거의 없었거든요.
네.
오늘 날 잘 본 것 같은데요.
저도 지금 빨리 말 그만하고
네.
게임으로 좀 보여주고 싶어요.
확실히 직원으로 준비가 됐습니까? 그러면 변현재 선수의 그 위대함에 있어서 그 이몽규 선수, 변현재 선수 어떤 프로토스라 생각하세요?
그냥 프로토스들은 한 끼 식사라고 생각하고 토스가 거기서 거기 아닙니까?
그러면 변현재 선수는 한 끼 식사 곧 굉장히 쉬운 밥이다. 이 부분에 있어서는요. 밥 같은 토스, 밥토스.
그런데 모든 선수가 저렇게 생각하거든요.
와!
그래서 이제 좀 프로토스를 너무 쉽게 생각하기 때문에 저거들이 좀 많이 지지 않나 싶거든요. 프로토스한테.
네. 그러면 이제 끝으로 이몽규 선수에게 한 말씀 해주시죠.
일단은 이제 4강 때처럼 빠르게 끝내 보도록 하겠습니다.
와! 조기 퇴근! 이몽규 선수 쉽게 생각하다가 저거가 지금 다 무너졌고 김명훈 먼저 무너졌다. 이제 이몽규 선수는 재물이다라는 이야기를 했거든요. 경기 시작 전 변현재 선수에게 한 말씀 부탁드리겠습니다.
4강보다 더 압도적인 경기력으로 승리하겠습니다.
강한 자신감으로 이번 시즌 우승에 다가가기 위한 준비가 모두 끝났습니다. 과연 이 두 선수가 앉는 자리 가져갈 트로피의 주인공이 누가 될지 온라인에 계신 여러분의 뜨거운 박수로 시즌 11 결승전 대결을 시작하겠습니다.
이미 멘탈이 깨졌어요.
대역전 최후의 프로토스
성공적인 전략을 두 번 갖고
이 연승 우승 차례 김병훈을 갖고 프로토스 현재 결승 진출.
미니
이몽규 선수의 꿈 10년간의 그 도전 그 끝에 드디어 이 벽을 넘어서면서부터 바로 결승 진출.
라바
다전제만 가면 자신 있었어요. 이제 저번 시즌 이제 아쉽게 16강에서 떨어졌는데 그렇죠. 이제 우승이 목표다 보니까 그 어떤 적어도 이제 4강에서는 무조건 이길 거라고 이제 생각을 하고 있었기 때문에 아직까지는 좀 무덤덤한 것 같아요.
복수의 성화 변현재 선수.
일단 시즌 7에서 이제 잘하는 적어들을 꺾고 결승까지 갔었는데
꺾고 2점 세트를 채울
제재.
결승에서 이제 테란을 만나서 제가 좀 무기력하게 졌는데 이번 시즌에 이제 결승에서 저그전이다 보니 좀 더 자신감 있게 할 수 있을 것 같아요.
누가요? 드디어 이 벽을 넘어서면서부터 결승 진출!
우승하지 않았기 때문에 진짜 실감이 안 나는 느낌인데 우승 말고는 다 똑같은 것 같아요. 원래도 잘했던 토스전 결승에서 한번 다시 보여주자라는 생각이 들어서 우승 확정?
커세원이 여섯 개입니다. 다 찢어요.
아예 턱 밑에다가 게이트웨이를.
저그의 시대 그 중심에는 김명훈 선수 무너뜨립니까? 칠레!
일단은 노서치 전략은 한 번도 나온 플레이가 아니었기 때문에 이제 어떤 저그여도 이제 토스전에 7선제면 무조건 자신 있어 할 수밖에 없기 때문에 안전하게 할 플레이를 예상을 하고 머리 꼭대기 위에서 이제 가지고 놀 수 있었던 것 같아요. 이 모습을 4강에서 보여줬기 때문에 이제 결승에서는 아직까지 머릿속에 그린 중이에요.
솔직히 경기를 안 봤어요. 예, 제 경기 준비하느라 안 봤는데 뭐 노서치? 저도 할 수 있거든요, 노서치. 뭐 서로 서치를 안 가게 된다면 누가 더 궁금할까요? 오버로드로 볼 수 있는 저그가 더 유리하지 않나. 대체 명훈이 형이 왜 진지 모르겠어요.
지지!
처절 그 자체였던 것 같습니다.
뭔가 성장하고 더 배웠던 계기들이 됐던 것 같아요. 그러니까 저는 상승을 잡은 게 아니고 거의 뭐 동일선상에 있는 프로토스도 충분히 저그들한테 할 만해진 상황에서 잡은 거기 때문에 더욱더 험난하다고 생각을 해요. 최종적으로는 저저전을 했던 게 토스를 잡기 위한 좀 밑거름이 아니었나 그렇게 생각을 합니다.
시즌 5 8강 세 번째 경기
네. 치질 거예요. 이렇게 아
악살입니다. 악살.
병력 숫자가 많지가 않아요.
견제 그 견제.
그때 홍규가 이제 오프라인에서 엄청 못하는 이미지라서 8강 상대로 엄청 원했던 것 같아요.
뭐 저보고 오프라인 못한다 그러는데 제가 AS의 시즌 4에서 4강을 그때 갔었거든요. 뭐 변현재 선수는 어디에 있었나 싶을 정도로 어딘지도 기억이 안 나네요. 네. 그래가지고.
기억이 안 나는데? 근데 시즌 5때 홍규는 생각보다 엄청 못했었거든요. 제가 안 그래도 저그전이 자신 있고 그 당시에 맵도 좀 괜찮았고 그래서 이제 그때 이제 결과가 3대0으로 나온 거고 이번에는 이제 홍규가 조금 더 강해졌기 때문에 이제 결승까지 온 거라 생각하고 좀 준비를 잘해야 될 것 같아요.
그 당시에는 이제 맵이 좀 저와 맞지 않는 부분들도 있었고 뭔가 제가 보여줄 수 있는 기량을 못 보여줬다라고 생각을 해요. 하지만 이번 시즌에서는 뭐 불편한 요소들이 없고 또 저와 걸맞는 맵들이 좀 많이 포진되어 있기 때문에 자신 있게 우승할 수 있을 것 같다라고 말할 수 있을 것 같아요.
일단 제가 저거 전에 제일 장점은 그 어떤 토스보다 이제 초반에 질럿을 잘 쓸 수 있다는 게 제일 장점인 것 같아요.
경기 자체가 난장판입니다. 아주.
네. 루키가 또 들어왔어요.
질럿 따라 있긴 한데 질럿 컨트롤해요. 하나도 안 죽었습니다. 질럿이.
상대가 스트레스를 받아 하는 거를 이제 좀 좋아하는 것 같아요. 처음에 프로브부터 상대를 견제를 해야 이제 행복하게 게임을 시작할 수 있고 이제 그 다음 나오는 이제 질럿으로 상대를 때려야지 상대가 스트레스를 받아 하는 모습을 보면 이제 제가 좋기 때문에 그래서 미소가 지어지는 것 같아요.
지저분하게 한다고 해가지고 원래 녹아 있었던 그 피지컬이 흔들리지 않거든요. 저는 약간 이렇게 생각을 했어요. 옛날부터 피지컬적인 부분들이 완성이 돼야 다른 전략적인 빌드들도 충분히 수행이 가능하다. 그 전략만 먼저 한다면은 그 이후에 운영이 안 되거든요. 그래서 기본이 안 돼 있죠. 예. 이제 후반 가면은 진짜 10판 하면 한두 판 질까요? 예. 톱스전 제 강점? 흔들리지 않는 편안함? 그거에 걸맞게 좀 잘 수비를 해내면서 운영으로 이끌어 나가는. 사람들은 뭐 중보적이라고 부르잖아요. 하지만 절대 그냥 버티기만 하는 게 아니거든요. 언제나 역습을 대비하고 있는 그런 적이기 때문에.
요즘은 이제 좀 잘하는 적들을 보고 배운 건지 조금 생각 있는 플레이를 좀 많이 하더라고요. 근데 홍규도 아직은 무식해요. 일단 홍규가 예전부터 엄청 노력을 많이 했는데 우승까지는 아닌 것 같고 준우승이 딱인 것 같아요.
질척 토스? 그냥 변태가 아니고 그냥 질척대는데 어떻게 떼어내나 한번 보여드리겠습니다.
그럼 진짜 질척임이 뭔지 보여줄게.
네가 운이 좋아서 올라왔을 뿐 잘해서 올라온 건 아닌 것 같은데 뭐 변태 플레이 한 번쯤은 당해준다? 쳐도 4대1?
홍규야, 넌 아직 우승할 그릇이 안 돼. 내가 4대0으로 이겨줄게.
여러분들, 이 트로피 조금 있으면 제 거가 될 것 같은데 기대하셔도 좋습니다.
All right, we are finally here. What an insane intro that was for the ASL Finals. This is Mini versus Larva. And I don't know who's going to take it. I think it's going to be really close. I think the games are going to be exciting, also really educational. These two players have very different approaches in the matchup. Yeah. And I just can't wait to get this thing started.
Oh, I know. It's actually kind of a dream final, honestly. When we had that round of eight, I wasn't really sure what we were going to get, but it looked like Zerg versus Zerg to me.
You know,
with Queen being there and everything, winning the last couple seasons. But now that Mini has made a fool of Queen and gotten right up into the finals and Larva looking the best he's ever looked, this is just a match made in heaven.
And it's funny, when you looked, like you were saying, what we thought was probably going to be a Zerg versus Zerg finals, I knew Mini was good, I knew he was on the cutting edge of PvZ, but I just assumed that Queen was basically that wall that no Protosses could really pass, right? So to not have Queen here is insane, and shows you how quickly the landscape is changing as far as who's improving and getting better. In fact, we can see how the story unfolded down here on the brackets, but these two guys have had very interesting histories. They are players that we always knew were good, a big fan favorites, both of them very emotional, and they've both managed to overcome all odds and get to this finals.
I know. It's kind of crazy when you look at it. Like, for instance, this has been a pretty one-sided round of eight bracket. If you compare it to all the other brackets we've ever done in the other 10 seasons of ASL, this is the most one-sided that we've seen thus far, with only Larva Rush being a 3-2, everything else was pretty damn one-sided. The fact that the round of four was one-sided as well, that kind of blows me away.
Yeah, that was a big surprise here. Our map lineup, this is actually a cool way this is going to unfold. Polypoid to start things off, Eclipse, Hidden Track, Ascension, Polaris, Rhapsody, Ultimate Stream, and we might end this where it all started, Artosis, Fighting Spirit.
Oh my god. Imagine that. We finish it off on Fighting Spirit. Yeah. I really hope we get to that seventh map.
I think we will.
I think there's actually a very reasonable chance we can get to the seventh map. And I know that, like, that's what commentators want. That's what fans want. But honestly, looking at these guys, I can really see something like that happening. Because Like, Mini looks like the best PvZ that there is, easily, but Larva is a smart guy, and he had a lot of games to watch, right? Like, he played against Queen in 8 games already, so that is a ton of information for Larva to take in and figure out how to stop everything. But Mini is also so strong. Dude, it has to be 7 maps.
I do want to point out, you know, first of all, Mini has always had a very obtuse playstyle, especially in PvZ. But I don't know how that's going to interact with the way Larva plays. Mini is known as being basically the best corner cutter in the matchup, mm-hmm. right? Core before Forge. Sometimes even if a Forge is made, there's no cannons. Bizarre tech switches, mm-hmm. like a second later Stargate, like we saw against Queen. Mm-hmm. Also, he's a hyper-abusive Protoss player. I mean, he's not afraid to proxy gate. He's not afraid to cheese in any weird way. And overall, he's solid and strong with robust macro. Now, when you look at Larva, this guy really plays Zerg in a very different way, especially in this matchup. He's much more reliant on Mutalisks early on,
mm-hmm.
which is
That's actually a very good point. I hadn't thought of that.
Which is usually I guess you could say a little bit more of a cheesy approach to the matchup.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sorry, did you just turn me down a little bit? I feel like my volume got lower in my ears there.
That's right. I did. You were maxing out, Tasteless.
Okay, sorry.
I am the PD here, Tasteless. Don't you break the fourth wall between us.
So Larva likes to do a lot of these air openers. He likes to try to match the Protoss with
mm-hmm.
Scourge, which is interesting because basically most people would conclude that Corsairs are actually considerably stronger overall when fighting Mutas if you get good engages. But Larva's very good at flanking and taking those fights.
That was something I wasn't thinking about as much. I was thinking more broadly like what his strengths were. But you're really right about that Larva prefers Muta Scourge much more than basically any other top-level Zerg. We really do see him go for that a lot. Is that going to pay off against Mini or be bad against Mini?
Also, it's worth pointing out that nobody's been Hydra Rushing Mini, if my memory serves me correctly.
Pretty much, yeah.
Which I hadn't really thought of up until we just started this cast. Like, he's cut a lot of corners, yeah, but he also, nobody ever attempted to punish him.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I mean, it's not like he's just flipping coins here and gambling. He's doing some very good scouting to ensure that he can get away with that, but I would be curious to see if we're going to have Hydra Bus here at a PvZ. It seems like you would have at least one Hydra Bust.
Yeah,
least one in a best of seven.
I think normally you'd have 4, and then the series would be over.
And then I go, yeah, but that's what my games look like, too.
Yeah.
So, I mean, we'll see what happens. Larva is not exactly known to be a guy who Hydra Busts a lot.
Mm-hmm.
It's not like Effort or
you're very right.
Queen likes to do Hydra Busts.
Well, no one's like Effort, but yes, you're definitely
Effort
right.
Effort has never seen a layer before in his life, man.
Effort, so, Soma, some of these guys are like incredibly aggressive with those Hydra Busts, but you're right. Like, Larva doesn't do that as much. He prefers to go for a more turtled approach, to go for those Mutas and Scourge. Like, he has a very different style.
There's also, and I don't normally say this about any player in Brood War, but I will say it about Larva. He's very stylistic in prepping for a best of 5 and best of 7. He seems to want to show a very wide range of play.
Mm-hmm.
Like you were just mentioning Soma. We might see Soma do the same stuff over and over again in a game.
Yeah.
In any matchup.
No, it's true. Larva does a good job planning series a lot of the time, don't you think?
I would totally agree with that. I think out of all the races, he's very masterful at basically having, you know, an opening from one game complement the opening in the next game, and that he's given certain impressions and he can kind of juke and jive in and out of different styles. You know, watching this here with Mini, I'm most interested in basically seeing how the opening of the game is going to go.
Yeah. Like, does Mini have some crazy cheeses ready for us? Because definitely it's something that we've seen in the past where he's gone for things like center 2 gate. And that could be something that he brings out, but he didn't use that against Queen, right? Like, he was using, like, lots of Zealots and very odd different types of timings and styles, but we didn't see the more aggressive Mini that we've seen in previous seasons.
Yeah, he seemed to, and I mean, this might have been something that you can only plan for against Queen. I mean, Queen's got a lot of data out there about how he plays. This is what happens when you've won 2 championships in a row, is you really can be dissected on a level that a lot of other players can't be. Mm-hmm. I wonder how risky can Mini get in this game? I'm also wondering how many times Reavers are going to be used here.
That's Mini, a good question. He's not as much a Reaver guy, is he?
Not really, right? No. Like, I don't feel like we've seen a lot of Reaver games.
No, not much.
I mean, obviously, any, you know, ASL Protoss player can use Reavers against Zerg, but this was really actually quite trendy 3 years ago. Was a lot of abrupt Reaver openings, like Speed Lots and then Reavers, or Corsair Reaver was more common. And Reavers seem to be phased in and out of the meta a lot. But anyways, guys, we're ready to get this going. The Season 11 ASL Final starts now with Mini versus Larva.
Larva chose blue. Tasteless, what does it mean?
What does it mean?
So Polypoid, our first map here in the bottom right, our Protoss player, Mini. And in the top left, our Zerg, it's Larva. This is... Oh, I am actually super hyped, man.
Well, this has been, first of all, an amazing season, but it's not the finals we expected. You know, with Flash on his hiatus in the military, and Queen looking just untouchable, the question was really, can Queen win a third time in a row? And then we're entering this pretty incredible territory of dominance that we haven't really seen like that in a while, if it wasn't Flash, I mean. But both these guys have been trying to get into a finals and trying to win a major title like this for a long time. And it's going to be dramatic no matter what the result here.
Yeah.
Why are you laughing?
Well, I just like that pylon when it went down, like when we first came back to StarCraft.
Well, I'm like, did he block his
Nexus? Well, I was saying that all the time, like to the point where it became a joke where like every pylon I'd be like, did this block the Nexus? And then you in control and Day and I was like, no, he didn't. Wait, stop blocking. I'm like, I'm pretty sure it is, guys. That made me think of that.
Yeah. So it's going to be gate opening here. Now, this I did expect here from Mini.
I don't actually think we're going to see any Forge openings unless he's trying to Cannon Rush.
Yeah, and there's some maps that are better to Cannon Rush than others. And I mean, it seems like, in fact, I would say Forge opening might be the least likely build from Mini.
Yeah, I agree.
I think it's more likely he makes two gateways in his main.
I think you're right on that. I actually think we're going to see 0 through 7 games, but if we do see one, it will be a Cannon Rush game.
I agree.
Or he'll want to, and who knows, maybe it's a pool first so he can't, but Mini is not, I mean, he doesn't make cannons oftentimes until his Stargate is started, so like, he, why would he make that right away? That doesn't even make sense.
Now, we should also point out, like we were mentioning before, Mini had a series of very strong one base games as well. Just while we're letting this game heat up here. Now, this is a fake Cannon Rush.
Yeah.
And this is to generate panic here for Larva and force him to pull more drones.
And Larva going to bring one drone. It seems like he's not panicking at all. Like, the second goes up, so should pull a second drone. This should force a second drone.
Well, this
one's going to cancel in a second.
This is a pretty insane bluff. So... It didn't actually work.
Yeah, he didn't even bring the second drone. Like, you need a second one to hop the drone over. I guess maybe you can do an extractor cancel to get it over.
It's hard to extractor cancel north.
Yeah,
I believe. But in my experience of watching people try to do that to me, it seems like they don't get up there that easily. So basically the idea was he wanted to force, you know, maybe 5 or 4 drones to come down here and attack. And then the Zealot would run in there and start hitting different locations. So, you know, a little bit of a slowdown here.
Well, it's a mind game that Mini... Wait a minute. Did Mini lose a mind game? Mini lost
a
mind game. Well, I'm calling it here. Larva's taking this championship, Tasteless.
He's going 4-0.
Mini was unstoppable with mind games before, but now he's just... He's falling flat in his face. The pressure's gotten to him, Tasteless. The pylons didn't work.
So he's hit his Zealot up here at 12 o'clock, and this is the normal spot a drone would go to make a hatchery.
Yeah.
You can expand onto the high ground area just south of this position here, but it's easier to turtle with your hatches at the other spot.
Yeah.
And so he sees that, in fact, there's no third hatchery.
Whoa.
Two hatch hydra. Yeah. But Mini's going to be suspicious. Now, there's one other dilemma for Mini in the scout, and that's that is this guy playing scumbag Zerg where he took another natural? Because when you're in these spawns, it could be to the top right or the bottom left.
I guess you're right.
But we were talking before the game started. Is Larva going to Hydra bust? Oh, yes, he is. This is one of the fastest Hydra busts.
Busts. The fastest, right?
Pretty much, yeah.
And, okay, so this is actually, and we were talking about this, I believe, when we were casting some of the other matches, that, like, this is really smart, I think, of Larva to do this in game one. Because if Mini wants to play his very canon low abusive style,
yeah,
that's very greedy, if you can make him fear the Hydra Bust game one, that is going to trickle through all seven games.
Yeah, exactly. If you strike fear in his heart, this is going to absolutely...
Yeah. It sounds corny, but it's real.
Yeah. No, it really is real.
It really is real.
If you show you will do the cheesiest Hydra Bust to start things off, more cannons will be made over the course of the games than otherwise. Now, he's got one cannon making. This is the corner cutting Mini here. Right now, this looks extremely strong for Larva.
But, you know, what is there? There's four Zealots out right now. Only one cannon.
Yeah, only one cannon. The second gas is already finishing. That's how much this guy likes to.
Yeah, no, he's being Mr. Greed here.
Yeah, Dr. Greed. It's crazy. He's
Dr. Greed.
Dude, he's Count Greedula. Okay?
Sir Greed, yeah. I don't know how to beat that one.
Yeah, I think we can't top Count Greedula, honestly. Okay, so notice that he's keeping the Hydras back.
Yeah.
He hasn't shown a single one because a lot of Zergs will run up here with Lings and they'll sort of try to telegraph behavior of this rush. So this is really a pretty masterful game. But I will say, I think he's going to realize what's coming.
Dude, the Hydras are actually not in range of where this Corsair is looking. Oh, my God. Oh, my God. He has kept this so well hidden. Oh, that's the first sign of Hydras right there.
Oh, my God. There's not enough room for these cannons.
No, I don't think that there is.
Now, I don't know how quick Zealot's speed is going to finish, but I don't think it finishes in time to save the day here.
I don't think so. I think he's going to die.
I believe you're correct, Thurtos. This just doesn't look good.
He's almost got that second cannon. One cannon remains. Another one is warping in, but there's a ton of Hydras here. And I guess he can dodge that cannon on the other side and then move up when the probes get pulled back. Here we go. Gets on top of it. Going to blow that cannon up in a matter of seconds. The Zealot dies as it comes out. So do the probes. And Mini punished for his greed.
Oh, and did you see his face when he tapped out?
No, I didn't.
Super frustrated.
Oh, man.
And look at that. Larva knows. Okay. He set his plan into motion. Mm-hmm. He's punished Mini's playstyle to start things off. And this is very tough here. How many more times is Larva going to play like that? And, of course, Larva doesn't have to do a single other Hydra rush if he doesn't want to.
No.
Which means that Mini may end up falling back into this cannon style.
Crazy.
Now, I want to point out, Mini, an extremely ballsy player when you consider that he pretty much scouted there was no third hatch and thought, I'm still going to get this.
What was that all about?
Well, he just thinks that it's good. I'm sorry, is that a hair dryer?
That is a hair dryer.
What?
Why? I think he's warming his mouse.
What?
I think this is the craziest thing
I've
ever seen in my whole life.
That's the weirdest thing. This doesn't even look like it's a meme. It's like, all right.
No, he has that there purposefully.
Get my hair dryer out here. What?
He's got to keep that mouse hot,
man. Now, I want to point out, now in other esports events, we're going to start seeing hair dryers pop up.
I'm literally on Coupang ordering a hair dryer right now to figure this out.
What?
This is already the greatest finals.
I was so, yeah.
To hatch Hydra Bust into the
hair dryer on mouse?
Yeah. Oh, my God. Amazing.
We're going to find out that mouse has a wig.
He's going to dry it off.
Yeah.
You sweat too much? I'm like, a towel does the same thing, bro. Yeah. No
problem. Like, do you really want to heat up your electronic devices? I mean,
are we going to melt the
plastic? Do you also give
mouse?
Your mouse a bath? Like, what else are we going to do here? Guys, we're going to go to Eclipse after this short break. We will be right back. Wait for the chorus. Isn't it gorgeous? Hit them with precision, boy. We're making them forfeit. Of course, it's a lot to contain. We got to refrain. It's getting even harder with the bots. 팀의 유망주로 촉망받던 프로토스가 있습니다. 연습생 신분을 벗어나지 못하고 꿈을 펼치지 못했던 저구도 있죠. ASL 시즌 11 결승전에 오른 변현재와 이몽규 선수의 이야기 함께 만나보시죠. 2010년 상반기 드래프트 4지명으로
FTX에 정식 입단하며 프로게이머의 꿈을 이루게 된 94년생 소년이 있었으니 그것이 바로 프로토스 변현재. 팀에서도 주목해야 할 선수 1순위로 꼽으며 많은 이들의 기대감을 증폭시키던 가운데 2011년 12월 그토록 바라던 꿈이 이루어집니다. 바로 대망의 첫 프로리그 출전. 방송 무대 데뷔 전에 상대는 웅진의 에이스 윤용태. 신예 선수가 베테랑을 이길 수 있을까? 나는 걱정도 잠시. 외제보다 더 강력한 스톰을 바탕으로 첫 데뷔 경기에서 승리를 해버리니 이게 정령 신예인가 아니면 꽁꽁 숨겨둔 에이스인가 싶을 정도. 그리고 이후 출전하는 경기마다 스타일리시한 모습들을 보여주며 스타 팬들에게 변현재 이름 석자를 제대로 각인시키고 탄탄대로를 걷는 줄로만 알았는데 이 이후의 이야기는 잠시 후에 계속 이어집니다. 변현재가 STX에 입단한 2010년 이몽규 역시 이스트로의 연습생으로 들어가 프로게이머의 꿈을 꾸는데 그런데 이게 웬일? 팀이 돌연 해체를 선언. 꿈을 접어야 하는구나 싶기도 했지만 여기서 포기하라는 법은 없는 건지 기적적으로 포스팅 대상에 포함되며 SKT 연습생으로 합류. 2011년 상반기 드래프트에서 1차로 지명되며 정식 입단까지. 앞으로 나의 시대가 열리겠구나 생각한 것도 잠시뿐. 선배 저그들을 넘어 엔트리에 들어가기는 왜 이렇게 힘든지. 현실은 형들 세레머니 보조하면서 결국 공식전 출전은 제로. 그렇게 뭔가 보여준 건 하나도 없고 브루드워로 진행되던 리그도 하나둘 저물어 가는데 과연 이몽규는 어떤 선택을 하게 될지 이몽규의 이야기 잠시 후 이어서 만나보시죠. 다시 변현재의 이야기입니다. 스타1에서 꽃을 채 피우기도 전에 들려온 브루드워 리그 종료. 스타2로 넘어가며 우여곡절이 있었지만 결국 팀의 우승까지 이끄는 에이스로 성장한 변현재. 다시 순항할 길만 남았구나 싶었지만 우승은 했는데 왜 계속 가지를 못하니? 팀이 사정상 해체를 하게 되면서 자연스레 변현재도 프로게이머 은퇴를 결심하고 군복무 문제도 해결한 후 처음으로 도전한 ASL 시즌 3. 아직 무대 적응이 완벽하지 않았던 타치인지 2패로 탈락. 이어진 시즌 4마저 탈락하게 되면서 그냥 그런 프로토스로 남게 될 즈음. 남자는 3세 번이라고 했던가 세 번째 도전으로 나선 시즌 5. 여태까지 쉽게 넘지 못했던 24강의 벽을 넘어 16강마저 1위 통과. 8강에서도 3대0 승리. 생애 처음으로 시드를 획득한 변현재. 기세를 이어 시즌 6에는 8강. 게다가 시즌 7에서는 무려 저그전만 17판을 치르며 결승 진출. 과연 그 이야기의 끝은 어디로 향하게 될지 잠시 후에 다시 만나보시죠. 이어서 이몽규의 이야기입니다. 스타크래프트 브루드워 리그의 종료와 함께 빠르게 은퇴를 하고 개인 방송을 시작한 이몽규. 2015년 ASL의 전신이라고 볼 수 있을 대국민 스타리그에 진출하며 드디어 처음으로 방송 경기에 출전하는 꿈을 이루게 됩니다. 그러나 프로게이머들과 부딪히는 벽은 높고도 험난하기만 하니 출전하면 16강, 24강을 거듭하지 못하고 거기에 설상가상 건강상 문제도 겹치며 힘든 시기가 찾아오죠. 그리고 ASL 시즌 4. 아니 이게 맥그리고야? 이몽규야? 완전히 달라진 외모에 실력까지 가미하며 생애 처음으로 4강 진출. 이어진 시즌 5에서도 8강의 고성적을 거뒀지만 잠시 휴식을 위해 한 시즌 불참을 선언합니다. 다시 돌아온 시즌 7. 아직 완벽하지 않은 모습으로 두 시즌 16강에 머물렀지만 시즌 9에서 4시즌 만에 8강 진출 성공. 그 다음 시즌에서는 결국 시드까지 획득하지만 아직 넘어야 할 벽이 있었으니 그 이야기는 잠시 후에 돌아와서 만나보시죠. 다시 변현재의 이야기입니다. ASL 시즌 7 저그 선수들을 모두 제압하며 호기롭게 결승에 진출했지만 알파고 앞에 아쉽게 무릎을 꿇은 변현재. 준우승 이후 극심한 징크스에서 빠져나오지 못하며 기나긴 슬럼프를 맞이하고 맙니다. 그리고 2021년 ASL 시즌 11. 24강은 다소 힘겹게 뚫어낸 느낌이지만 이번엔 다르다는 것을 제대로 보여주듯 16강에서 디펜딩 챔피언인 김명훈을 만나 저구전 스페셜 리프트다운 모습으로 제일 먼저 8강 진출. 이어진 8강의 상대는 괴수 도재욱.
16강 뚫으면 이제 저구전이나 테란전하면 자신 있다라고 생각을 했는데 그렇게 좋게 생각하진 않았어요.
동축전을 조금 피하고 싶었는데
프로토스전이 좀 까다로운 것 같아요. 라던 말이 무색하게 3분 40초 9분 그리고 다시 3분 40초 17분이 채 되기도 전에 3대0으로 승리하며 내 시즌만의 시드까지. 그리고 다시 4강에서 만나게 된 건 프로토스의 제왕 토스전 승률 1위 김명훈이었습니다. 1경기 준비했던 캐논러쉬가 실패하고 스텝이 꼬이며 패배. 이번 시즌도 왕자가 아니라 전기의자에 앉겠구나 싶었던 그때 다크템플러가 본진을 뒤흔들며 2세트를 가져오고 5세트에서는 100만 프로토스의 기운을 모두 모은 듯 혼신의 수비를 보여주며 1년 반 만에 프로토스 결승 진출자가 된 변현재. 동족전보다 오히려 저그전이 쉽다는 평범하지 않은 프로토스 변현재. 과연 그의 시즌 마지막 페이지는 어떻게 마무리될지 잠시 후 경기로 확인해보시죠. 이어서 이몽규 이야기의 결말입니다. 시즌10에서 다시 시드를 얻는데 성공했지만 항상 본인의 발목을 잡아온 저구전 다전제에 걸려 넘어진 이몽규. 4강에서 김명훈을 극복하지 못하고 결승의 꿈을 접어야 했죠. 그리고 ASL 시즌 11 3번 시드로 조지명식에 참여한 이몽규에게 짠미통이라는 도발을 하는 선수가 있었으니
도와줬으면 좋겠어 영규야.
오오오.
저는 홍규보다는 짬제가 잘한다고 생각하거든요.
ASL에서만 상대전적 6대1을 만들어내며 이몽규 선수의 천적이라 불렸던 김태경입니다. 아감하게 조지명식에서 김태경을 데려온 이몽규. 김태경의 심리를 제대로 파고들며 승리하고 강윤철과의 승자전에서도 업그레이드된 멀티태스킹을 보여주며 3시즌 연속 8강 진출이라는 업적을 남기게 되죠. 이어진 8강에서 만난 상대는 끝장전에서 1대8이라는 굴욕을 안겨줬던 테란 유영진. 중간중간 고비가 찾아오기는 했지만 집중력을 잃지 않고 풀세트 끝에 승리를 얻어내고 맙니다. 다시 한번 결승의 꿈을 이루기 위해 올라온 4강. 역시 이몽규 선수를 맞이하는 것은 저그 조일장이었죠. 시즌4에서 조일장에게 무너졌던 기억. 그리고 지난 시즌 김명훈에게 4강에서 패배했던 기억에 또다시 저그전 다전제에서 무너지는 게 아닐까 싶었지만 전혀 다른 모습으로 4대0 셧아웃을 내며 11년간 그려왔던 꿈을 완성하는데 단 한 걸음만 남게 됐습니다. 스타크래프트 역사상 가장 변칙적인 프로토스 변현재 그리고 피지컬에 전략을 탑재한 저그 이몽규. 걸어온 역사는 달랐지만 생애 첫 우승이라는 같은 꿈을 향해 달리는 두 94년생 동갑내기 선수들의 결승전. 과연 이번 시즌의 주인공이 되는 선수는 누구일지 이어서 확인해보시기 바랍니다.
Welcome back, everybody. We're going to be going into Game 2 in just a little bit. What an insane start to this.
Yeah.
We've seen Larva come in here. Balls out, man.
Yeah, yeah.
And punish Mini for being this corner cutter.
He really did. Two hatch Hydra all in, and the fact that Mini couldn't find the third hatchery and still did not defend heavily.
It's pretty
his
wild,
own fault.
Right?
It's his oh, own yeah, fault. Yeah.
Like, honestly, that's Mini's, a flaw in Mini's playstyle there. Mm-hmm. Because most of the information was there. Granted, like I said, in cross spawns, it's difficult because they could take the other natural at the top right or the bottom left. But you got to assume, mm-hmm. right? Like, you know, something's going on here. And of course, this is kind of the big talking point of Mini's play is he seems to be able to get away with what nobody else can up until now.
Yeah. Well, we're going to see if he can bring it back. Now we're going to be going to Eclipse. This was Mini's pick, so definitely the map he feels best on. See if he can do it against Larva. Navy this time. What does it mean?
So I guess the big question is, will he Hydro Bust again? Maybe that's the big question for many, actually.
Yeah.
Is now that, you know, Larva has shown he's capable of doing super all-in stuff.
Mm-hmm.
By the way, there's not a lot of recovery room, if any, with two hatch Hydra all-in.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, usually with three hatch, you at least, let's say the Protoss barely survives.
Mm-hmm.
You've got three bases. You can go back to making drones. They did spend money on cannons, and that stifled their development. But I don't know that we're going to see that same type of build again. Like the
it seems unlikely. It seems unlikely for sure. One thing I want to point out, like, Mini really tried to sell Cannon Rush game one. That could be leading into a game two. Eclipse is generally the most popular map for Cannon Rush, right?
Yeah, Cannon Rushes are quite strong on Eclipse, especially in the southern spawn. But with him sending the probe back, it looks like this will probably be a gateway opening.
We'll see if that plays into it all. Maybe he'll continue to fake Cannon Rushes, right? That's something we've seen, like, in StarCraft
sure.
2 from SOS. He'll prime you through an entire best of seven for one game, right?
Yeah, there's very few players, even nowadays, that I think have truly mastered the dance of a best of five or a best of seven just in build order rotation.
Mm-hmm.
I think SOS has been one before. I think we're looking at Larva as one of those guys as well.
Seems quite good at it so
far. Flash, certainly, of course.
Yeah.
That kind of goes to that.
Well, Flash thing. Can do anything
yeah.
in all seven games
yeah.
to be favored. So. Yeah, yeah. Now, going for the pool first here, so good thing he's not trying any sort of Cannon Rush or anything. Mini scouting across. Going to see the lack of the hatchery. And go right up for that scout. Any thoughts here? Is this just to keep Mini back at the beginning, or was he maybe suspecting that there could be a Cannon Rush?
No, I mean, this is a pretty standard way to approach the game here from Larva. We don't really know his true intentions just yet. This is, I would say, nowadays, at very high levels, this is the opener you see interacting together the most, which is...
Over pool versus gate expand.
Right. Now, he did succeed with the pylon block. He'll have to cancel that. And seeing six links come here, the Protoss will not be attacking. It would be
yeah.
very, very risky to do that. And so you basically play this tight defense game. It took me a long time, you know, when we came back to casting this to try to get a handle on this build because there were so many
yeah.
sets of decision trees.
A lot of small decisions at the beginning that have huge weight.
Yeah, and if the Protoss can basically do the dance correctly,
mm-hmm.
they're fine. But if they make a mistake anywhere early on, the game unravels pretty quickly here. So with the Sixlings coming, he's got the exact right idea. Putting the pylon here to block punishes the Zerg for the aggression.
Good micro there from Larva, though. Almost gets the probe. Brings it down to low, low, low health. A little bit of harassment here by Larva on those links. Ooh, trying to bring them up to maybe slip beyond the Zealot or get a flank. A good micro from Mini holds it off.
Yeah, and Mini's done an excellent job interfering here. That hatchery is finally going to start, but, I mean, he's basically held this position pretty beautifully. Note that we are not seeing Mini rush into gas right away or get the core at the entrance, but he's kind of forced into making that forge when he sees the six and then eight links coming up.
Mm-hmm.
You know, let's say that Larva had made four Zerglings. That's when I think we would probably see Mini switch into... you know, a cybernetics core and all that. But this time, this is more down the middle of the road here for PVZ.
You know, the Zealot right now kind of pushing those lings back as he makes the Nexus gas on the way. And, you know, looking at the two builds so far, I feel like Larva's done a good job interfering with the general way that Mini wants to play, right?
And it's another Hydra Bust.
Oh, my God. A three now, hatch this time, though. This is the macro Hydra Bust.
Yeah. Well, here's what's funny about this. Notice, you know, I said this is looking pretty normal. Once again, Mini didn't make a cannon. He got the core before the cannon.
Mm-hmm.
And Mini's always been the master at getting away with this kind of stuff, but he's in a danger area again.
Yeah,
now
it's a little bit scary.
He can't be punished yet, but, you know, that beating the probe took, making the pylon, it's that much more of a vulnerable target. I should point out that the spacing at the third base on this map
mm-hmm.
is a little bit better for the Protoss in that you could fit more cannons there.
Do you mean the natural or?
The natural.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. You can actually have two rows of cannons. In
yeah,
the last
yeah,
game,
yeah.
you could only have one.
Mm-hmm. No, totally. His building layout really looks like you can fit like a ton of cannons there if you need them. Throws down that Stargate, but I mean, it's going to be a while before that Corsair is out. He sends out the three zealots, and these three zealots, so important for gathering information.
Yeah, these zealots, I think Mini's done a very good job. He has two back at home, just in case Lynx try to run. And now notice he sees slow Lynx.
Mm-hmm.
This is a little bit unusual and a little bit risky here for Larva, because speedlings will just kill the probe. Slowlings kind of make it look like it's a macro game.
Yeah.
But it does mean that if he doesn't kill the probe, this probe is going to see Hydras coming out.
Yeah.
And so Mini's done the dance pretty well. He's also made quite a sizable amount of lings here.
Hold on, Tasis. I got to go. He's going to get it. There it is. Probe goes down. And he hit a bunch of lings there as well. Speed already done for these Hydras as they start to move out. Two more gates going up at the natural, kind of a funny location.
That's a very curious location. I guess he wants to hide the gates if an Overlord comes in.
Yeah, maybe.
You know, we don't normally see Protosses hide gateways, but I guess you can do that.
Maybe he's planning on losing his main to Mutas, and then he has the gates at the natural.
That's so funny.
Larva does like Mutas.
Yeah. It's just a much better way to play.
That's the way I would do it. It gives me a fighting shot to stay alive for 10 minutes.
So the Hydra Rage is going to finish in a second here. And we got to see if there's going to be enough to actually hold this all off. Now, he is going to be able to stop the attack upgrade coming here. And this is 3-gate speed lot.
Now, the Zealots are actually coming out, getting on top of some of these Hydras, and they're not moving. Well, I guess good choice there. He starts to pick them off quite a bit.
He's almost killed off this Overlord, by the way.
Yeah, getting it very, very low indeed. And now the Zealots getting on top of these Hydras once again. Is this the right play from Mini?
I don't know how close that is, but you can see Larva's having none of it. He actually targets down the Forge, picks that off.
Well, if someone is that desperate to trade that many Zealots, it must be pretty close. Right?
Larva's controlled this perfectly.
I'm a bit nervous for Mini here, right? Doesn't this look pretty solid for Larva? He's been droning up behind it, adding some macro hatcheries as well. He's gone up to 5 hatch.
Yeah, but the Protoss is going to survive this attack.
That's true.
That's very important to note here. The game goes on. Mini, he still has his two gates that are going to be down there, tucked in that location at his natural. But Zerg can drone up. And there's losses on both sides. It might look like only Protoss lost stuff, but, you know, Protoss is making probes that entire time.
Mm-hmm.
So they are economically in a pretty good spot. But these Zealots are going to be considerably less strong because they can't kill stuff as quickly as they could if they had that +1 attack upgrade.
Very painful. He will pick off a few units as he runs across the map, but just missing that +1 is so painful for Mini. Not only missing the +1, he spent a lot of Zealots trying to save it.
Right.
And so when you add all that together, like, he could have had like 10 +1 Zealots with speed. That sounds a lot better than what we see him running around with.
So he's got the Templars coming out now, and it doesn't look like there's any real weak spot here. We should note that the Sim City here for Larva isn't exactly one of those like impregnable fortresses that Zerg can make.
Yeah.
But that's fine, because he can still hold.
Yeah, it seems like the way he's laid out that base is the "I am completely unafraid of you" layout.
Yeah, it's "I'm going to have stuff anyways" layout.
This is the easy way to macro layout, you know? Mm-hmm. Like, there's different ways that you can place buildings that are more defensive, and then there's different ways you can place them so that you can more easily macro, and he's done the more easily macro way.
And on that note, Artosis, if you look over where Mini put those gateways, that's hard to macro out of.
Yeah.
The reason why most Protosses don't even make their second gate at the natural is just because it's annoying to macro from there.
Yeah, totally.
When you get into late game, it's at least one extra screen you have to click on.
All right, well, there is a DT out. Muta's flying across the map here for Larva. Kind of an interesting switch from him. Start to hit some of these Zealots, so it's giving some advanced warning. Only a single Corsair, huh?
Yeah, this is a smart move here from Larva, because he knows that you have to cut Corsairs to hold the rush. He gets his Mutas later on.
Mm-hmm. And he's actually made cannons in both mineral lines. He's got High Templars sitting in both areas, throwing the storm down. Doesn't seem like Mutalist Craftsman's going to do very much, but I guess you can force your opponent to make some additional Corsairs, maybe, or an Archon to try to stop the Mulas from picking everything off, right?
Yeah, well, five seems to be the number where it can be. Well, how many does he have here now?
Corsairs?
I think he has. No, Mutas. Oh, it's still five,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, it's five or six.
Yeah, forcing Corsairs can be very good.
I think he's not going to make more, though. He's got like two, and that's it.
Well, he might not. You're right. He has certainly encouraged the Protoss to basically. Whoa! Okay, that's huge. I don't know that many can push now.
Yeah, losing two High Templars there. Barely hitting the Mutas. I mean, they are very low on health now, but it feels like this six-hatch Hydra macro from Larva is going to be very tough for Mini to deal with going forward. Look at those supplies. Already, Larva within five supply of Mini.
Yeah.
That's scary.
Interesting to see that he didn't overmake Corsairs. But, of course, that means that those five Mutas can actually kill a Templar. It's kind of a funny back and forth. Some Zergs will get up to, like, 11 Mutas and just keep dive-bombing the Templars. Now, I don't know that Mini's going to commit, especially when those Templars were killed. He may just end up taking another base. But you can clearly see, I mean, Archons alone are not adequate
right?
defense against even this small number of Mutas.
I know. He's fighting so bravely with the Mutas, like he doesn't even care. He's just,
yeah.
He's trying his best to get off some of these High Templars. They have taken damage, but he backs them up, saves them for now.
But now there's lurkers up here. I don't believe there was an observer with that army either. Right?
No, there's definitely not. Oh my god, he picks one of them off. Cases, this is not going well for Mini.
No, I mean, basically, oh man, hold on a second.
Oh,
oh my god,
god,
he needs a storm like right now.
Oof. He's lost like five High Templars so far this game, unfortunately. Now he's got all these Archons sitting around, which are not going to be nearly as helpful against Lurker Hydra. Seems like a very tough situation. He's going to run past, has some cannons at the third base on the high ground. Don't know if that's going to be enough to hold.
It's pretty incredible what Larva did this time. He made only five Mutas, which allowed his Lurker tech to be that much quicker.
Mm-hmm.
And Protoss is not prepared for this. I think the observatory is finishing right now, and there should be an observer making, but this army's actually stuck out here. This looks like it should be a 2-0.
Yes, it really does. Like, Larva is smashing everything. He's way up in supply. You can see Mini looking defeated.
Yeah, well,
on his player cam.
He's had a really rough go so far.
Yeah, it looks like Larva's getting ready to just bust everything. And so many Hydras at home. Mini cannot really do much of anything here with this counter.
Yeah, this is just not enough. You know, it's not going to cut it. And these Hydras are going to win this. I think we're going to go into game three in a second. I mean, this is just basically over. But again, Larva, really the master of navigating the game and basically exploiting the decisions that he's forcing Mini to make. Crazy.
Yeah. This, like, I think Mini is just settling in for him, basically, right now. There's no way for him to win this game at this point. He's down, like, 30 supply, down two bases.
Well, this is usually the nail in the coffin here, is the Lurker contain. All right, GG. Larva up 2-0. He just needs to do it one more time. Win two games, and he moves on.
Yeah. That's pretty impressive, right? A two-hatch Hydra into a three-hatch Hydra, but that game, of course, three-hatch, not winning it straight up, but getting him into an advantageous position. He went up into six-hatcheries, Mutalisks, back over into Hydra Lurker, and just stomped Mini. It seems like the preparation that Larva has put in is paying huge dividends so far.
Yeah, Larva seems to have a very good handle, not just on the race Protoss, but on the mindset of Mini and how he wants to approach this. And it's funny, because he made the five Mutas. Now, Mini only made two Corsairs, right?
Mm-hmm.
But he still made Archons.
Mm-hmm.
He still pushed out. There it is, that hairdryer.
Dude, he's using the
hairdryer. Maybe he's cooling off the mouse pad or heating up the mouse pad?
No, I don't think it would be the mouse pad. I think specifically it would be the mouse, right? Because he's right-handed and he's spraying it over there on that side. So it should be... it should be the mouse. I think he's just trying to keep it warm.
I thought I was ready for this cast until the hairdryer came up, and I thought I didn't.
Well, it's,
That is the thing that no matter how these games go, we will never forget this finals.
We'll never forget this.
Definitely our first hairdryer finals. Will it be our last?
Well, I can't wait until Razer puts out a gaming hairdryer that has LEDs on it.
That's a green glowy hairdryer for gamers.
Totally. Just a crazy series so far with Larva being up 2-0 after the domination he showed against Queen. I don't think many people expected for Mini to come out the gate and get stomped 2-0 to start.
Well, this looks like it's a lot of prep into how Mini approaches the matchup overall. It seems like Larva is extremely aware of the corner cutting, where it didn't seem like Queen was really that prepared. Queen kind of... he got owned pretty bad.
Mm-hmm.
He almost got embarrassed by Mini because Mini was able to kind of pull off all these tricks.
Yeah, yeah.
But Larva's playing a very tight game. He's opening up in both game one and game two with pure aggression, where if you don't respect it, you will lose the game. And it's pretty incredible to see how in game two, then he basically does the dance perfectly.
Mm-hmm.
Larva, of course, known for going mutas basically more than any other Zerg in the world in this matchup.
Only
makes five. Still, Mini's cutting corners there, but manages to get the advantage by having the lurkers there before observers are available. Zealot Archon is not good against lurker.
No, it's really not. Like, Archons in general, they're great against mutas, they're great against lings, but as soon as a sizable number of Hydras come in, they really lose a ton of their value.
I mean, they're good if they get to actually fight the muta, but the Archon is a funny unit because it's not really that great in general.
Mm-hmm.
You kind of get it because you don't want your Templars to just die.
Yeah.
And usually in these fights, as things are thinning out, an Archon can kind of win. As the unit count is whittled down to a pretty low number, it's usually beefy enough it can win. And then you can pull it back and group it together with your army. But I'm worried here for Mini. I'm really, really worried.
Yeah, no, I am too. And don't forget, he's such an emotional player that he might tilt out of control at this point. Larva, I feel like he can see victory.
I feel like the adrenaline here with Larva is palpable.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, look how sweaty he is right now already. Yeah. Like, he is hyped. Now, how much of that is from the games and how much of that is from the hairdryer, I don't
know. That's the question. Maybe Larva's figured out something that we all need to start doing, and maybe down the road in the future, they'll be talking about, people used to use hair dryers to dry your hair. Can you believe that?
That's crazy.
That's before gamers used them to improve their play. But yeah, that was a funny time.
that was a funny time.
They were a primitive people, them using their hair dryers on their hair. Okay, we've got both our players sharing the top here. It's Mini in the upper right, already shaking his head.
Yeah, one of his probes did a little spinny whirl.
Oh, yeah. And Larva in the top left. It may be subtle, but that's a very Korean frustrated kind of tick.
Yeah, the head to the side thing is, it's... Everyone does it out here, just so you guys know.
Yeah,
It's like a
cultural mannerism.
Yeah.
That we see. From time to time. So it was just kind of funny. We got him on camera and you immediately saw him frustrated.
Mm-hmm.
But I'll tell you what, I mean, this is kind of, when PVZs go wrong, they look like the games for Mini.
Yeah.
Like, you know, all the matchups have different parameters that they're operating under. But one thing for Protoss is if the game is going to be a standard PVZ at all, like you're not making gateways in the middle of the map, it's a tech progression that takes a long time to finish. And things that can interrupt that progression are extremely common, and that's what we're seeing here. These Hydra busts, basically, he wants to get Dragoons with range, but he thinks that the Mutas are coming, so he has to try to respect that. So he starts to make more Corsairs. He makes two Archons, which is an extreme counter to that if you actually have to fight Mutas.
Mm-hmm.
But Mini's not able to really finish the painting he's trying to make.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying?
No, totally. But this is great strategy from Larva because anytime you're in kind of a high stress situation, if you can screw with your opponent's plans, just in general, that's going to mess people up. You have to have like the greatest championship players will look at that cheese and be like, oh, this is going to be easy now, right? Like, you get someone like a Flash or a Bisou or a Jadon who has won countless titles, and you throw this type of stuff at them, they'll be like, fine. But everyone else in the world, as soon as you start dictating the way that they have to play, it makes it a lot more difficult.
Now, Mini actually went for a little bit of a gamblertosis.
He did.
He did the sneaky Nexus on 12,
mm-hmm.
Which is very strong against standard openings. Obviously, it immediately loses to a 4-pool or something like that. It, I believe, loses to a 9-pool as well, but I don't know. I've never actually...
Yeah, I'm not sure.
I don't... This is not a build that's in my wheelhouse, really. I mean,
this is not a ladder build.
Yeah.
Or this, maybe it is a ladder build, which is the gross part.
Yeah, well, I mean, it could be if you're fighting somebody you think is way better. But, you know, with the amount of rushes, I mean, 4-pulls and 9-pulls are kind of like the center gate of this matchup. So he went with it. There's Ling's coming here. Is this cannon going to finish in time?
Well, he's got enough probes. I think he's going to be fine because they have to come in single file to fight.
Yeah. Ooh, he's so good. Now, can this Ling actually get around there? He could try to block.
Come on.
What?
That was like 7 watts on both sides.
Yeah.
First off, Mini, you could have killed that. Second off, for Larva, that shouldn't have jumped over there like that.
Yeah. Yeah. Almost looked like he was debating doing a cannon rush, by the way, in the
third base. Look like that, didn't it? You know what?
I think he stopped because the Ling got inside. If the Ling's inside, then you see nothing's making. You go, oh my god, I'm getting cannon rushed.
Oh, maybe. And actually, the other Lings are going back towards there, so he maybe is sniffing that out as well. But also, I feel like in a situation like that, if you're down 0-2 and you decide to make a cannon rush at the third base and it doesn't work, you are not the ASL champion. It is not going to happen at that point, okay?
Yeah.
So it's probably a good call to not put all your eggs in the I have not practiced this and sometimes Protoss players try it and it almost never works basket.
Yeah. I like the core put over there. Did you see that?
No, where
core's was it? Actually put on the above the cannon.
Oh, cool. I want to see it. Bring me back there, Tasis.
Well, it's a good thing I'm in control of the mouse right now, and I'm just
you're
clicking
so selfish with where you click.
See, yeah,
there it is.
There it
okay.
is. I clicked on it for you. You like that?
Why is that good, do you think?
Well, it's just the Zerg doesn't see the core right away. It's the whole thing is, like, Mini has gone so far out of his way to hide everything. Mm-hmm. And, you know, honestly, we don't really see Protoss as hide gates and hide the core.
Yeah.
But this is only because normally the game, the core is so part of the standard development. Mm-hmm. Except for Mini,
yeah,
who
true.
Cuts corners so much that he actually has to obfuscate even these starting buildings of the
game. Yeah, no, totally. Because with Mini, with everyone else, like you said, right? Like, it's you get your cannon and then you get the core, and like, this is how it goes. With Mini, I mean, he even toys around with core before gate builds. Like,
yeah.
he'll do anything.
And this is a pretty good move by him to actually get the zealot down here. Oh, my
God. Oh! I can't believe he got that drone. Nice.
Yeah,
he kills on this Zealot.
He's traded extremely well. Okay, so what's it going to be? Attack, we have a Citadel. So we no Stargate. That's the question I was asking. Again, that is also made in natural. just in case an Overlord flies into the main.
Mm-hmm. There is a Spire on the way, so this could be a Mutalisk opener, which I think for Mini would be kind of rough.
Yeah, it's definitely not what you're hoping the Zerg is doing. Is if they're going to go for the...
He's spinning the core. You know what? I wonder
if
that...
Wait, now?
Oh!
What?
Okay, because when the core was spinning, there was no Stargate. I'm like, maybe he does that to fend off Mutas, because then you're like, well, he's getting plus one. Because
no, you'd
never get range this early. You wouldn't do that.
Yeah, no, I literally was looking at that and thinking, oh my god, he's getting...
It's next level, but you know, it's actually the level right before that where he's like, no, I'm getting plus one because I need Corsairs.
Yeah, we're like, oh yeah, well, upgrades are pretty good.
Yeah. But I also want to have some Zealots on the map. Is that okay, guys? Yes, Mini, it's fine. We're very excited for your build.
Now, these Zealots don't quite have the upgrades. In fact, it looks like they're going to be killed right before their upgrades could have finished. So this went about as bad as it could have gone here for Mini. And is he going to see? Okay, he'll see the Scourge hatching. The screen's over that, and I imagine it was. Is that a second Stargate? Oh, please click on that Observer. Really?
You know what? It might be. Its placement, I think it is a second Stargate, Tasteless. You wouldn't put a gateway there. You don't want a gateway above your gas in the main base.
Yeah, it's two Stargates. Okay. Still no attack upgrade here. But Artos found that one funny.
I did. It's like, is it a Stargate? It's like, I'm, yeah, I mean.
Artosis was tickled by that one.
I was tickled. That would be like you put your gateway like in your mineral line. I'm like, what? Your mining is worse now. Why are you doing that?
It gave Artosis a spit bubble laugh.
That doesn't make any sense.
My whole life is this game, so this is funny to me.
I really get it, and that's why it's funny to me. So
that's exactly what it is, yeah. Too.
So he's actually bought a lot of time here with these mutas. And I'm sorry, with these zealots, yeah. The mutas haven't actually really.
The corsairs should be sick here.
Yeah, I think the corsairs are going to be enough. It's interesting to see more and more people just going hard into double Stargate to kind of really mute the threat of the mutalists, because you know throughout the history of StarCraft, obviously people always made corsairs to stop mutas. I mean, they were literally built by Blizzard to deal with mutas.
Yes,
because Protoss actually had an extremely hellish time trying to fight mutas. But when you get two Stargates at once, you don't lose tempo. Whereas if you have one Stargate, if you lose any Corsair, you know, they can produce at such a quicker rate with their Mutalists that the game can still be lost. So it seems like you just kind of lean in hard to the Corsairs and then stop when you think you can stop and tech normally.
Well, he's got a lot of them coming up with these Zealots as well. This is pretty scary, to be honest. Throws down a Spore, but obviously these Corsairs can do some serious work still. The Zealots cutting through one of these buildings. Mutas coming up and, of course, getting shredded by those Corsairs. This is starting to look pretty darn good for Mini.
Yeah, no, I mean, Mini's basically winning the air fight, and I think the game could snowball. It's a little bit tricky for the control here on both sides, to be honest, but I think he's actually chewed his way through. Yeah, now he's on top of the Sunken Colony. And I think when the Sunken Colony pops here, this game is going to spiral out of control. It doesn't mean Larva can't come back, but it does mean that he no longer has the power of that static defense. And really a Zerg base in this position without a Sunken Colony versus speed lots. I don't think that Zerg got armor, by the way. Notice how he's going for the Spore.
Yeah,
because he knows that there's going to be Overlords over here eventually. And if you can just make it not safe, like he is right now. See, the Corsairs can come back.
Totally. And look at this. Zealots running away. The Corsairs come up to kill off those Mutas, push them back instantaneously. The amount of damage he is doing here.
That's it? Yeah, he cracked them.
Not surprised there. Wow. Very nicely done there by Mini. Doesn't get screwed up at the beginning of the game and is able to really manhandle Larva there.
Yeah. He should have hairdryered more. That was... You should have set the hair dryer to high and not medium. What is he doing?
I know. It's a little bit tricky with that.
Yeah.
You don't.
I mean, I gotta ask the question. I mean, was this hair dryer even plugged in?
Is this a plug-in one? I feel like you'd bring a batteried one. Yeah. But battery ones can't achieve the same amount of heat. We all know this about gaming hair dryers.
I mean, it's one of the things you need to know if you're gonna be. Playing as ZVP against
people
Mini.
Ask me, how do I break into A rank? I'm like, well,
yeah.
What type of hair products
and
do you
all I
use?
Need to do is pat them on the top of their wet heads from their showers and say, you just don't have what you need. Yeah. Oh, is that right? Do you just leave your house with that wet hair and let it dry on your own? And you wonder why you can't get a higher rank.
Oh, man. 100%. Right. Mini put himself on the board. I was a little bit nervous there at the beginning. But looks like we're going to go to a quick little commercial break. And when we come back, it's going to be game number 4.
On your marks, get ready. 관리받다. 관리하지 않는 순간에도 관리받다. 14일 동안 정성껏 발효한 브루잉 콤부차로 관리받다. 브루잉 콤부차.
디자인하면서 가장 중요하게 생각했던 부분은 울트라 기어의 차별화된 브랜드 메시지를 잘 나타내는 것입니다. 신과 영웅들의 최강의 무기들을 검토하였습니다. 그중 니케의 승리의 날개를 모티브로 지금의 울트라 기어의 로고가 탄생하게 되었습니다. 울트라 기어의 이니셜인 U와 G를 비상하는 날개의 형상으로 레드 색상을 사용하여 강력한 에너지와 힘을 나타내었습니다. 울트라 기어는 최상의 퍼포먼스로 진정한 게임의 즐거움, 승리의 기쁨을 여러분께 선사할 것입니다.
야채 착착, 당토 톡톡, 아보카도 슥슥, 그리고 제로! 이렇게 맛있다고? 맛은 배로, 칼로리는 제로. 칠성사이다 제로.
아이시스 에코, 오늘 내륙의 찰떡.
마시고 분리수거 끝!
많은 분들이 아이시스 에코를 따르고 있습니다.
어? 이것도 라벨이 없네?
무라벨은 따라해도 대환영. 팔로우디 에코, 아이시스 에코.
숙취 요즘 누가 저렇게 깨니? 맨날 똑같은 거, 맛없는 거.
깨. 이제 탄산으로 깨. 숙취 해소의 새로운 기준. 깨스깡. 환도 역시 깨스깡이 대세.
울트라 기어로 선명하게 이긴다. LG 울트라 기어 게이밍 모니터.
Okay, everybody, we're back. We're ready here to go to game four.
Almost ready to go into
game four. Guys, I lied.
Yes, but let's just talk about what is going on in ASL world. Okay, so basically we've been hinting to you guys that we're trying to get some more content to cast for everyone. And what we're trying to get right now is ASTL.
We were hoping we could tell you guys that we got it. We don't know yet still.
Yeah. We're still working hard on that, trying to grab ASTL to cast all of that season.
We might get it. We might not get it. We don't know yet.
That's right. But either way, there's going to be a little bit of downtime after this ASL Finals here tonight. So we are going to put on some additional bonus content for everyone. Yeah. We're gonna put together a little pro gamer King of the Hill that we're going to be casting live on our own streams and throwing onto YouTube as well.
On our respective Twitch channels, it's going to be a little bit of extra content for you guys. We've set a new goal on the Patreon. Obviously, the support on the Patreon has been amazing. Patreon.com/ASL English. We're going to be doing it whether we hit the goal or not. But this is some extra content we can give you guys and keep more StarCraft 1 content going in the downtime because obviously it's going to be a while before we get to ASL Season 2.
Yeah, yeah. And so, guys, we're gonna put that together, and we hope that you enjoy it. But you know what? On to the ASL Finals.
Enough. Bring me game four. Mini, right now, I'm glad he won a game. I was actually getting a little bit worried this would be a 4-0, mm-hmm. but he did come out on top. And again, it's that strange Mini style. He squeaked out really quick Zealots with speed, and then hard shifted into Mass Corsair.
Yeah, yeah. That, and I mean, that worked out so well for him. Larva, yeah. You pointed out very aptly that he does like Mutalisk play, and he really got broadsided by that double Stargate Corsair, and then the speed loss just kind of running around causing havoc. It was a tough game for Larva. So this series, I feel like after that game, that kind of resets a lot of what's happened so far. You know, Larva can't Hydro Bust every game, and now he's tried to go into his more normal style of taking another natural, going Mutas. He wanted to go four base. He already had a drone ready to take that hatch, and Mini plowed through him. So where does Larva go from here?
It's a good question, because Larva played the game that usually he dumpsters Protosses with, and that time Mini was pretty smart to... And again, it's an unusual build. Citadel then into Stargate is just not, you know, a build you're going to teach your friend when they're trying to learn the game, right? I mean, definitely. It's a very odd way to play the game. Mini's kind of shown you can shuffle the tech a lot more than we thought was possible here in PvZ. Okay, we're ready. We're going to go into game four. Right now, Larva with a 2-1 lead. The Minster and the Arvlarv duking it out.
Choosing red this game. God, Mini not caring about his colors.
Does that mean he's a Capricorn?
That's the worst type of no. Halloween candy. He better not be a Capricorn.
Did he not listen to his tarot cards? What is he doing?
All right. We're on Ascension, Tasteless. Three-player Blue Storm. And, you know, after the first few games, I was like, wow, Larva's really controlling this. This looks fantastic. But now that he tried to go into his regular play and cut, as you said, he normally dumpsters Protosses with that. Well, he got run over by the trash truck when he was trying to dumpster Mini there.
He got trash trucked, you say.
He got trash trucked, man.
I mean,
he got pinned up against the dumpster he was trying to put Mini into because Mini was driving the trash truck. It was bad.
He got crushed like Shredder in that garbage truck.
Yeah.
Okay, so I do also want to point out, you know, first of all, PvZ, I think one of the great late games of RTS, right? I mean, you know, with the Storm and Defilers and all these kind of crazy units that can be used together. But we haven't had any late-game PvZ yet.
No, not yet.
These games have been, on either side, somebody's plan has been punctured, and the game has been forced to an end because these guys understand on such a complex level the ins and outs of you know, how the races operate. We're really seeing a pretty insane mind game here.
Yeah, it you know, I think that actually goes to show. People might not understand this and think, like, oh, these games are not going late. Like, maybe these guys aren't playing that well. That actually means that they are playing well.
Mm-hmm.
When you get players playing at, like, the very top, as soon as anyone screws up or gets caught, they die.
Exactly.
And that's kind of what we're seeing here. So this is, like, basically whoever's won each game is really outplaying their opponent, whether that be strategically or macro-wise, micro-wise, whatever that might be. A lot of times when you get scrappy, long, crazy, base tradey type games that people enjoy to watch, those are generally games where you've seen a lot of mistakes on both sides where there could have been kills and there just weren't.
But once more, the gateway opening is the way to play here. He's going to be having the Zealot slow drift come out, and Larva's going for three hatches.
Yeah, looks like that. Just the very standard. Nexus coming up here for Mini. We'll see how he keeps this this pressure on with the Zealot. Is it going to go to the third or the Nat? Normally goes to the third, but the third is so far away.
Yeah, it's... We'll see in a second. I was actually kind of deep in thought thinking about something that I've only seen Flash do, and I was wondering if Mini might do it, but do you ever see...
Two hair dryers?
Two, exactly.
He actually has one of those hair salon hair dryers over his head, the like, dome that goes around his
puts
head.
Puts a mouse on his head and puts it over there.
No, but did you ever see Flash and PBZ do this, like, weird two-gate after? Like, he goes gate Nexus, then makes another gate immediately in pressure with Zealots.
Oh, no, I haven't seen
yeah.
That.
It was, I don't know if it was actually that good. He was experimenting. This is when he was playing.
Probably the best build, and people won't see it after 10 years.
It'll be 40 years from now. We're finally doing it. Yeah. We saw Flash do it once, and he was just sort of messing around. Basically, my thoughts are racing right now with all the weird things Protoss could do.
Yeah, yeah.
Most PVZs, guys, you've heard us cast 1,000 times already, mm-hmm. right? I mean, we're watching for all-ins and stuff, but mostly it's Protoss teching up in the same pattern we've always seen. By the way, there it is again, the cybernetic score in the wall instead of the forge. But I think this is actually now going to be part of the meta permanently here if they do overpull.
Yeah, I've seen actually a lot more of this. Particularly, I've seen several Stork PVZs lately. Mm-hmm. Just kind of randomly, some games I was casting and stuff. And he was doing this a ton. The core in there, and even going for cannons after Stargate in some of the games as well. So definitely, it's starting to affect the metagame.
Keep in mind that although he can't scout right now, he does see there's no link speed. That's a very important thing to look for here.
That evolution chamber, is that normal timing on 3 hatch?
It seems like it's pretty quick.
Okay, yeah, it felt just slightly quick there. So what does this mean exactly? He just wants to get, like, very quick what? Like, I could see all 3 upgrades being, like, possibilities.
Well, Zerg don't usually get melee attack as the upgrade. It's usually going to be missile if you're going for Hydras, or you can go for armor. To basically deal with the Zealots head-on. Because Lings with armor and Zealots with attack, the attack is basically muted.
Yeah, it is. Well, I guess we'll see in about 2 minutes what that upgrade
yeah,
is.
I don't know how else to tell right now. It is a Spire that's done. No second gas, so there's not the hint of any full-on mass speed of play, but... Who knows? Zerg might get their gas in a second here, and we'll know.
Corsair on the way right now. Fourth Zealot pops out. Another cannon coming up, as well as a gateway at the natural. Loves to put those gates to the nat. Yeah, get some nice hits there.
Yeah, Mini just so effective at basically cutting the line here.
Mm-hmm.
And so this, the Zealots are now going to be putting pressure on here. He is going to catch an Overlord in the middle. I'm always interested in the decision by pros. Do you go for the Overlord or do you just do a full scout?
Yeah, yeah.
But it seems like with his Zealots on the move, he wants to try to supply block Larva here, and he will do that, by the way.
This is interesting. He actually went for a Spore very quickly underneath his Overlords here. That's not something that...
That's an old way to play.
But he's getting a Spire, so is he trying to... Like, why would you do that when you're getting Spire? Is your Spire just too slow here?
I think... Maybe he's been conditioned by Mini to be very worried about, very worried about double Stargate.
Okay.
But yeah, no, you're right. It does seem to be a bit redundant.
Yeah, yeah. That's why people Spire Rush a lot of the time is to get those Scourge out to stop.
Yeah, you can
everything.
You can head on. Yeah. Stop the Corsairs, and both sides have to back off and. Respect the other side.
Mini has shown us a lot of crazy DT play, a lot of crazy double Stargate play.
That's very
so.
True.
I'm not hating on it. I'm just wondering about it.
And the SimCity, by the way, the third is going to be pretty difficult to deal with.
Mm.
Now, Zealot Speed just finished. The plus one's going to finish in a second here. Can he actually get in here and do any damage, though?
You know, I bet it's Carapace, man. The amount of lings he's
making. Yeah, this for sure has to be Carapace inbound here.
Yeah, we don't see that upgrade done yet. Plus one is done here. A lot of lings flowing in at the moment.
Yeah, Muse
is coming
out
as well.
I don't see the Corsairs anywhere.
I think they're flying across the map right now, but the Zealots getting a ton of damage here. They're going to be able to bust the second Sunken as well. They start going after some of these drones and splitting up also. The Corsairs flying across the map.
It seems like he doesn't want to attack out until he has 5 Corsairs. That's kind of the number where the Corsairs are really a threat.
Yeah, they two-shot Scourge at that point.
Oh, and there's only 4 here. I guess the 5th one's going to be on the way. That's it.
Just a GG.
Just...
Very fast. Very fast.
So, we got to point out again, Mini had only 2 cannons there, which is fine. I mean, it's not like that's... But he got the gateways out very fast.
He got the speed lots out very quickly.
Mm-hmm.
I'm kind of shocked that Larva lost the game like that. Like, that just seems... Okay, here's how I'll put
this.
The Hydra Bust game one, ingenious, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then in game two, I think he really did the dance of controlling the tech very well. Now Larva seems like he's tried to settle back into the builds he's been doing before, and it's completely getting wrecked by Mini.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. These builds looked more normal for Larva. Like, he tried to dictate the flow of the game in the first two, and he did a great job of it. And now that he's playing his game, it seems like Mini's game is better than Larva's game. Seems like Larva has to do things to stop Mini from hitting Mini's game.
This all goes back to Cybernetics Core before Forge. Mm. The fact that the Corsair gets the kill on the Overlord that much more quickly. The fact that Zealot's Speed can finish that much more quickly. It's all going unpunished here, as Mini's basically leveled up the entire matchup for the race, Protoss here. And, I mean, you can see the most pro games don't look like that, because all these builds are basically engineered to prevent certain attacks at certain points in time.
Mm-hmm.
But now we're in a new level where Zergs just don't seem to know quite how to deal with this.
Yeah. The thing is, the easy way out is to say, like, okay, well, if you just make Hydras early on, he has to make a bunch of cannons that slows his builds down and whatnot. But is that something that Larva could get back into and still win this series? Can he take two more games out of the remaining three?
I mean, I think he can, but I think he has to walk away from this three hatch, you know, into Muta. I don't think it's going to work.
It doesn't feel like it's going to work.
I mean, I know it's kind of his signature move, but Mini seems to have no issues fighting this.
Yeah.
So we're going to go to Polaris Rhapsody. Larva's lead is gone. I think the fear has sunken in a little bit here.
Sure.
Of this kind of weird style that Mini brings out. And maybe you start rushing again? I don't know.
I'm fine with him actually pulling some cheese out once again. Like, you got to dictate the game against Mini.
Absolutely. We're going to go to game five. The winner then takes the lead here in the ASL finals of Mini versus Larva.
Mini there in the top left and a Larva in the bottom right. It is Polaris Rhapsody, a two-player map. Very peculiar two-player map. The top right and bottom left corners have double gases with 3K gas each.
Yep.
The closest third base is a mineral only that's at a kind of an awkward location. But then on the sides of the map, over at 3 and like 9, you have gas bases that are pretty easy to turtle up. So sometimes that's where we see the additional bases taken. There are a couple mineral bases that are kind of in the middle of the map, but they're so easy to attack and so terribly positioned that you generally, like, maybe as a fourth base or a fifth base you could see that, but otherwise not a big part of the map.
Again, we haven't gotten to a late game PvZ. One side always manages to assassinate the other while they're in some form of development. But Mini is basically, now that, you know, Larva's kind of loosened up his aggressive play, Mini's back to his old tricks. That kind of weird text, you know, quick text as well. And it's funny to see Zergs guessing this much. It used to be the other way around.
Yeah.
Protoss is, you know, were
in
the dark and kind of had to really do their very best to get a read. But with this accelerated play style, I mean... Look, in a year from now, Zergs may have completely adapted, and this isn't as strong as it looks.
Sure.
Right now, we are in the middle of, I don't know how else to say this, but a crisis for Zerg in this matchup.
Yeah, well, it seems like Protoss really kind of, well, Mini specifically,
Mini,
figuring out a lot of different ways to play that seem quite threatening, really, you know, towing that line. And, you know, here's the thing. If you're not comfortable playing with defeat, you're not going to find the strongest wins, right?
Yeah.
Like, you have to be completely ready to die and lose a lot of games trying to cut everything possible to get to a build like what Mini's been showing us.
He gonna kill this drone?
I think he is, actually.
Yeah, there's nowhere to make an extractor trick on there. He's gonna get this drone. Look at this.
Larva is gonna flip his wig case.
Oh, God!
Oh,
you saw him swallow there,
yeah.
too. Like, everything is so fine-tuned for Zerg early on. You know, Zerg operate in the early game without very many drones. And to lose a drone like that?
Yes, yes.
Is
anytime a Zerg loses a drone early,
it's even
such
worse.
A big deal.
And then the pylon block.
Yeah, the first hatchery that he made is actually that bottom left corner, which is forever away.
I like it when you use teenage girl words in our cast. Like, it's like forever away. When you say it's going to take a billion years for this to finish,
is
I'm like,
a teenage girl
you thing? Are a teenage girl sometimes. It is very funny to me.
Wait, do teenage girls say, like, it's going to be a billion years or something?
Yes, sir.
Do they?
Yeah, for me, when
Damn,
I hear
man.
It, it's like forever away. I'm like, totes, man.
I wish you would say totes to the tasteless.
I'm like, this Protoss player is hella good at this game.
He's wicked good.
He's tasteless. Wicked good. Pretty gnarly setup down here in the third base, though. So there's going to be these two zealots coming down. And I think that actually Mini kind of slid these out as the Lings came in. Mm-hmm. This is a trick that some good players will do is instead of sending all your zealots back to defend, which is kind of the more logical thing, you just think counterintuitive where you attack out because they probably don't have that many Lings here. They're probably droning behind this. Now, in this case, Larva was prepared, but he's just going to go behind the minerals.
Yeah, well he's actually surrounded a little bit, so I think he might not quite make it there. Looks like the Lings will end up cleaning this up, but very annoying there from Mini. In the meantime, it looks like he cleared up all of the Lings that cut into his base. Did that pretty quickly. Didn't take a billion years.
Not a million billion years.
Such a boomer taste. you don't talk like someone that's cool and young
like
me.
I know I talk like an old man. I'm like, these games are malarkey. Look, I mean, it looks like Larva's doing kind of the same stuff. I'm not saying this isn't going to work. I just got to point out that basically Mini took him down pretty handily.
Yeah, he did.
When Larva did play like this. We don't have any Hydra busts, which, again, this is all fine. I'm just curious to see how the game's going to go from here. I believe he had one drone and gas, by the way.
Okay. I mean, Larva, if he's going to go up into Spire play again, it doesn't seem to work with one drone of gas, right?
No, I mean, it's... Well, he
okay,
puts three in
now,
so maybe this is something new in the build where you just have one.
Well, it looks like he was just super optimizing minerals for now, which would make sense. He lost a drone. You know, he had to make a bunch of Lings to clear out some of those zealots that came down. So, I guess, you know, that's totally fine. Especially if you're not going to make Mutas. It's not like you have to bank any gas.
Yeah.
Mutas are really the only thing that you have to spend gas on.
So, Stargate first, Citadel second, and there's that second gateway.
Loves that second gateway at the natural.
Yep.
Another cannon going down. Doesn't have that much intel out on the map right now.
Before, it was really just Bisu who made that second gateway there. Hmm. And other players kind of just...
Bisu?
Be suit.
Who's that? A Mini fan? Like, who?
Mm-hmm. He just watches Mini stream.
Yeah. The guy that copies Mini and then travels back in time to win MSL? Is that the guy you're talking
exactly,
about? The guy with
the
time machine? Okay, yeah.
Now, this build from Protoss, I mean, it's not actually that crazy.
No, it looks actually pretty normal.
Yeah, you just get two gates, and you have very quick speed lots come across the map. And
honestly, if you cover this up, I'd be like, I don't know, is it best playing, you know?
No, yeah, this is kind of within the realm of normal for Protoss, which doesn't mean it's bad that Mini's doing it. I just want to point out this is not as insane of a game. I think he did the same build in the last game, if I'm not mistaken here.
As this?
No, but I guess he got the core first, so it's not. He got Forge first this time, right?
Oh, he went Forge first because it was Nexus first in the last game on... Oh, wait, Hidden Track was...
No, we last game we cast, he went...
Yeah.
Wait a minute. Moving on, in this game...
No, last game was Hidden Track, right?
I think so.
Yeah. We've seen we've casted four games. It's like, what order were they in? I remember the Hydra Bus.
Hydra
very
Bus was
clearly.
The third game, right? so the
are we on Fighting Spirit yet?
Is this StarCraft 1 or 2? I'm not sure. So there it is, the second Stargate.
Yeah, well, you did this, make Mutas.
This is funny because it just seems like this is, I guess, the build. If you want to try to copy something, it's you go into this and get another Stargate if you realize that they're going to go for a Spire. Look at the scout.
Oh, he just barely doesn't block it. 86 health. Zealot gets in the main base. If he had blocked that a little bit quicker, this would be so much better. But I wonder, could this be a bait, Tasteless? Where you're like, okay, he sees my Mutas and he loves his Corsairs. But what if you make like three Mutas and go nothing but Hydra?
I mean, I think that that's...
Are you the greatest gamer, then?
You might be the greatest gamer of all time.
Dude, every drone is deep red right now.
Yeah.
This Zealot did so much yet so little.
He wanted them to feel pain and remember him, but that's not really the way to do it. So...
He should have used his words, not his fist, Aceless. Only psychological wounds last forever.
He told those drones their dreams will never come true. So the funny thing about this is, like, we've seen double Stargate before, guys. It's not like Mini's the first person to do it, but it's the delayed second double Stargate that's funny about this. Yeah. It's like you go into this and you go, oh, is he going Mutas? Okay, well, let's throw down another one of these. And maybe even do this if they go Hydra, too, because there's no way the Hydras can fight both at the same time.
Dude, that is a lot of Zealots to hold off of this small army. Got the two Sunkins, all these Hydras behind as well.
I think that he should abandon this. I don't think he can get in.
Really?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, there's just no way. And these Mutas are actually doing a ton of damage. Yeah, that Sunken Colony at the top left is literally, like, more secure than the Pentagon. Like, there's just no way.
Like, it's more secure than the Pentagon.
The President of the United States is not allowed to go near that Sunken Colony. That is the most secure thing I've ever seen.
That Sunken.
Yeah.
It's the greatest defensive structure ever
there's
made.
There's never been anything better at defense I've ever seen in the entire history of the game than the placement of that Sunk.
Oh, my God.
Let me tell you something. You have a maxed out Protoss army of just Zealots and no probes. Just Zealots. And they attack down there. Still a game of chance. Okay.
Reavers would probably miss shots on that Sunken.
Yeah, Reavers, the shots would probably bounce off of the Sunken Colony and fire back at the Reaver, exploding it.
Hey, a few DTs actually coming down, and with the amount of Corsairs out and most of the Mutas being cleaned up, I could see these DTs doing some serious work.
This is so funny to see the Mutas just used as a counterattack technique. Mm. Now, it's a good thing he got the score, because that seems to be the kind of follow-up plays. You basically end up with this pretty extreme amount of Corsairs that can just kill Overlords, whether your Hydras are there or not. So it's good he gets a spore there in this sort of weird ebb and flow of the new PvZ we're trying to unpack along with everybody watching.
Dude, this is a very interesting game because, like, the probe count is not as high as I think you'd like to see for many. Whereas I look at the drones, Larva has a lot of drones. He has a lot of hatches. He seems to be in good shape. Like, I really like Larva for this game right now. Look, he's ahead in supply already. We're not even to 80 and he's ahead.
Yeah, this is pretty cool to see. But I think, honestly, from here, this goes into a normal game. I think we're gonna actually get into late game PvZ. And this is one of the things I've also been extremely curious about is you know, who's actually better out of these two, once we get to a macro game, which it looks like we're finally at, by the way.
Mm-hmm. Mini right now on 1-1 upgrades. Looks like he is getting +2. Probably armor, I would guess. That's been really trendy lately.
Yeah.
A lot of Hydras being fielded. Overlord speed is done. Of course, we do have Psystorm ready here for Mini.
It should be noted that this organically allows the Protoss to not have to worry about Mutas sniping Templars.
That's true.
Build. You get the Templars out later.
Yeah.
And there's more tactics in between. But then, you know, a long period of PvZ like 3 years ago was just people making Mutas and sniping Templars and Protoss is dying.
Yeah. Took them a while for Mini to figure out that you just make a lot more Corsairs.
Yeah. You just sit on Corsairs for a little bit.
Speedlot's coming down here, but they're going to get flanked. He's got to be careful with that. Oh, these High Templars. There's a lot of energy on these High Templar Stasis, but does he have enough Zealots with them?
I don't think the Protoss can make this work.
No, I don't think so. I think he's going to lose everything, but the Storms are crazy!
Oh, this is really bad for Mini here. I mean, it's okay to lose these Hydras. I mean, you can replenish them. But to lose this many Templars, this really seems like a bad judgment call here from Mini. Keep in mind that Invincible Sunken Colony was also still down there.
Yeah, how is he supposed to? Storm doesn't even hurt Sunkins.
I mean, the Hydras aren't even really important at that moment. It's just you can't get in there. And guess what? Storm doesn't even hurt that building. So there you go. But Mini's going to continue to push out. He's trying to apply pressure. Mm. It does seem like Larva is stabilizing extremely quickly.
Yeah, a lot of Lurkers actually going to be morphed. And he's micing back his Hydras. He does have that +1 range attack. Mini definitely winning as far as upgrades go, but we don't see a third base, whereas Larva has taken his fourth, and it's done.
So, I don't know if he can get anything done with this army. And this also allows us to finally maybe answer the question, what does it look like Protoss is at as the game gets to this point? It doesn't seem like Protoss is in great shape. Now, I think some of this comes down to a poorly timed out attack, and maybe this is something Mini's still tinkering with. Are you gonna go for the Evo?
Yeah. Oh, well, this is the only way to kill the Sunken.
Yeah.
And actually, his Zealots kind of dance over each other. A couple Lurkers come up and burrow, but really they're running from that Sunken.
So he's gonna maintain his upgrade advantage here. He'll probably end up getting +2 attack before that Evo chamber is able to upgrade to the next armor level here.
That's kind of crazy.
And just now, Dragoon range has started. So this goes to show you where all that gas went. Mm-hmm. In a normal-looking game, we would have a bunch of Dragoons in the army. We would have Observers, maybe Observer Speed being upgraded. But when you dump that much gas into Corsairs, things kind of pan out a little bit differently, don't they?
Yeah, they certainly do. And now he's down 30 supply tasteless. I'm not feeling this for Mini right now.
No, I agree with you, Artosis. I mean, it just seems like, you know, as we get into a game like this, although it's been exciting to see what Mini's tried to do, it just appears like Zerg is eons ahead here.
Mm-hmm. So it's going to run up.
Or is there a toast? I just would say it's a billion years ahead. Yeah, I mean, he can't do anything.
A billion years is a long time, Jesus.
Okay, so he's got Dragoons, he's got Templars, he does not have a third base. I think he has his 8 gateways.
Yep, he's got his 8.
Uh-huh, but
now the Hydra's on the high ground here. Throws down the Storm upon them. Have to turn around. But it's just like there's so much supply for Larva. It seems like such a basic math problem here, right? Like Larva on this many hatches with this many bases and this many drones. And that many Hydras against this few army and that few bases?
Yeah, this is just, it's just hard for me to imagine any Protoss winning this game in this position. You know, a lot of, you know, exclamation point on the end of a Protoss lead is a healthy third base that's up. And then the engine is fully running. You can produce, you can roam. You can fight, you can start to do storm drops and all that. And it seems like it just isn't going to happen for a little bit. Now, look, Mini's going to win this fight. This is actually a pretty big deal because he didn't trade in there very well. But the Lurkers are now on the high ground.
Yeah.
Protoss has to fight up there. And you can't really take the center left on this map in this matchup.
Oh, you just, it's
Zerg will just stop you.
Okay.
If they're good.
Because it seems like he's kind of been stopped from 12 o'clock, which is what I always see Protoss take. But
right.
I don't know. Maybe you want to try something else?
Well, it
I
looks
guess he
like
busts a couple Lurkers left over.
Mini fights back. I mean, that was a very important fight that he actually took out those Lurkers before more Lurkers could reinforce.
Mm-hmm.
But again, it's 2-base Protoss versus 4-base Zerg. Mm-hmm. This cannot go on for much longer.
Yeah.
Or Mini is just going to be obsolete.
Yeah, he's closed some of the supply gap, which I guess is nice, but it's still a 4-base Larva right now. One thing, like you mentioned, right, he should have his plus two attack finishing up relatively soon here, so his upgrades are, like, massively ahead of Larva's. It's just, Larva's army is very large right now. We're going to have to see, like, the best storms ever if he's to win.
Well, also, the counterattacks like this. I mean, Zerg can kind of do... I mean, there's a lot of ways to wrap this game up, basically. I mean, you can see here, the counterattacks are actually insane. And again, I think the Protoss might have a better army overall, but you're just hitting too many locations. And so, I mean, you could try to take the fight down here. In fact, I don't even know if Protoss can win this fight. And now, in fact, the Hypers are going to sandwich here.
Yeah, with that flank, it's really looking like Larva is going to clean up absolutely everything and take the lead here once again in the finals. Yeah, just pain in Mini's face.
Yeah, processing the loss. I mean, whatever adjustments he's going to have to make, he has to do them now.
Oh, my God. You saw it. Did you see what he just did there? He was, like, rubbing his head like crazy. He is so unhappy with these results. And now Larva leads 3-2. He is on match point, championship point for ASL Season 11.
Laser-like focus here from Larva. We're really seeing two very different sets of emotions here. I mean, Mini can recover. Look, he absolutely can. I think that was a pretty gross reminder of where things end up as the game pans out. I think we can kind of look back into why PBZ developed the way that it did. When most people kind of thought you had to win in a macro game, Mini's coming here with this very creative style that kind of blindsides a lot of Zergs, but he didn't look very strong once all the tech was up, did he?
No, I guess not. I mean, hats off to Larva. I feel like he almost baited Mini into the double Stargate Corsair. He didn't overuse his Mutalisks, didn't overproduce them, really got his macro running, had the spores up for the DTs and everything. Beautifully done. Feels like he may have outsmarted him there.
Guys, we're going to go to Ultimate Stream for game number 6. You don't want to miss it. We will be right back.
양념 툭툭 올리브유 또르르 우와 그리고 제로 너무 좋다 맛은 배로 칼로리는 제로 칠성사이다 제로
디자인을 하면서 가장 중요하게 생각했던 부분은 울트라 기어의 차별화된 브랜드 메시지를 잘 나타내는 것입니다 신과 영웅들의 최강의 무기들을 검토하였습니다 그중 니케의 승리의 날개를 모티브로 지금의 울트라 기어의 로고가 탄생하게 되었습니다. 울트라 기어의 이니셜인 U와 G를 비상하는 날개의 형상으로 레드 색상을 사용하여 강력한 에너지와 힘을 나타내었습니다. 울트라 기어는 최상의 퍼포먼스로 진정한 게임의 즐거움, 승리의 기쁨을 여러분께 선사할 것입니다.
관리받다. 관리하지 않는 순간에도 관리받다. 14일 동안 정성껏 발효한 브루잉 콤부차로 관리받다. 브루잉 콤부차.
숙취 요즘 누가 저렇게 깨니? 맨날 똑같은 거.
맛없는 거.
깨. 이제 탄산으로 깨. 숙취 해소의 새로운 기준. 깨스깡. 환도 역시 깨스깡이 대세.
울트라 기어로 부드럽게 이긴다. LG 울트라 기어 게이밍 모니터
We are back, and let's take a look at that trophy.
Man,
is that actually a trophy? Okay, it is a trophy. I was like, is that stuck on the back of the set? All right.
Dude, one of these guys is going to be going home with that tonight.
And the other is going to go home feeling sad and bad. It's kind of crazy. We've got a finals with Larva and Mini. It's extremely close.
Mm-hmm.
Mini, if he wins this next game, it's tied up. If Larva wins the next game, the story ends. And Larva is the ASL season champion.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we've talked about it for a while that eventually Larva's probably going to win one of these things. But it happened sooner than I thought, assuming that this goes as well as it is.
Well, he is on that match point, and Mini is such an emotional player. Like, we saw him kind of flipping out after that last loss,
yeah.
Unfortunately. But we're going into Ultimate Stream, and I'm sure that Mini has something very powerful prepared for this map. It's maybe the most different map in the pool this season. So
he's done a lot of one gate expand. Obviously, the tech is the, you know, the real flavor added in there,
mm-hmm.
That gives the trouble for the Zerg. But can we have proxy gate? Can we have a forge expand? I guess actually he did do one Nexus on 12, but pretty much this tournament's been him. You know, attacking on one gate and then teching quickly.
Mm-hmm. Well, Ultimate Stream is a map that...
Will
you know,
he clip his fingernails? These are the questions we got to ask. I was telling Artosis on the break, like, I want to just have one of Mini's fingernails. Like, just maybe the index finger one. I can tape it to my finger so I can play.
Be better.
I think I might start playing better. Better
immediately.
Yeah.
For sure it is.
He gives me his fingernail that he clipped off, and I just put it in like a little wedding ring thing. I close it and bring it home.
That's how you propose one
That's
day.
That's how I propose.
So romantic. Oh my god.
Okay.
All right.
Yeah. Let's see what happens. As Artosa said, this
you're
is
so,
a different.
You're
map.
So disgusting, tasteless.
I use it when I play games. I put it in my mouth and think about Mini, and then I never lose. I've broken Artosis. Oh my god. Ultimate Stream for game number 6. Let's see what happens.
Gross.
Cut oh, long fingernails,
so,
man.
You're so pleased with yourself right now.
I just had to bring it up.
Yeah. Thanks. Thanks.
We were actually talking about this a while ago, that there's actually several pro gamers that had grown their fingernails out.
It was actually pretty normal back in the Kespa days.
Yeah.
Okay.
And they said it was because it felt better on their
the
hands?
On the keyboard.
Okay.
Yeah. Huh. That's what they said.
Yeah.
I don't know. So, Ultimate Stream, cross spawns. Larva likes to take another natural so he can secure four bases kind of free. That's what he likes.
I think that's like what most Zergs want. Cross spawns, I think, is probably better for the Zerg here.
Do you?
If I had to guess. Yeah, I think so.
The only thing that makes me wonder about it is that it's going to be closer for Protoss to attack your third base if you're taking another natural, right? which I think is probably what Larva will end up doing. So, because I guess I kind of think of it like I think of like a 5-rex plus one play, right? When a Zerg takes their third base as another main, if it's cross spawns, yeah, you can't attack them easily, but you can attack their expansion much more easily, right? So I kind of think of that here. I don't know if that's going to be something that plays into it.
It's Nexus on 12.
As it should be.
Yeah.
Honestly. It's a long map. It's hard to rush here. And is that something that Larva would do when he's on match point? Like, just gamble that.
Yeah, he's also not a nine pooler.
He is not
in
a
the
nine pooler.
Modern player. Right, in fact, right. I'm starting to wonder if we're going to see nine pool get cycled back in, like at the higher level.
Maybe.
Nine pool has always been on the ladder. It's one of the oldest builds, but I do wonder that when I see Firdaus is just getting away with robbery here.
Yeah. Well, I mean, a hyper-aggressive Zerg, the thing is, this is a tournament setting, right? Like, on the ladder, as you said, you always get stuff like that. But in, like, the tournament setting, would Mini be doing these builds against Soma or Effort? It'd probably look like a little bit different series, I would think.
I would think so.
Whereas Larva definitely is a macro guy. He does not as much want to do the rushes.
But, you know, the more I think about it, like, let's say I encountered somebody that was, like, 300 MMR above me.
Mm-hmm.
I think I might do this. You know, I think it's not as likely they're just going to nine pool. Maybe they do, but trying to get whatever benefits you can get. Mm. I'm curious with this build specifically for Mini, because Mini's already known to cut corners, you know, with getting the core fast, but this is already cutting corners by getting the Nexus first. So,
dude,
like,
Nexus
how
first
many,
in a gateway.
Yeah, not even a...
And gas.
Yeah, so, like, this is... on a level that, like, pre-StarCraft II Tasteless and even Tasteless from last year would have said is impossible to do.
Yeah, yeah.
Because it's just, it's like, I mean, this is like some Sonic the Hedgehog stuff.
gotta go fast,
dude. You gotta.
It's just the best catchphrase there's ever been.
I know.
Did he go core before Forge as well? He did.
Oh, my God.
So now he's gone Nexus first, Gateway, Gas, Core. Can we get two Stargates?
If this
Stargates?
Was the development of a human being, this is like a 14-year-old that's already married and has two kids. It's like, whoa.
So the Middle Ages is what you're
middle
talking
ages.
About.
So that's not what I meant. But
so
yeah.
This is some sort of Middle Ages build. All right.
So this
Got
is
it.
A very sad arranged marriage. I'm like, well, no, that's not exactly what I meant. I'm sorry. Yeah, this is
it's the greediest thing we've ever seen.
Yeah, well, it's just, I mean, I don't even know.
Well, I mean, this is like the worst map for Hydrobus too, right? Because
correct.
You have the ramp and everything. So he's like, because cannons would be too strong here, I won't make any.
Yeah, I won't even make the building that makes the cannons.
Well, he'll make that eventually for upgrades. But I guess we'll eventually see a cannon. Yeah, there it is. Do you think that might be too early, that cannon?
Yeah, I think he's really playing like a wuss, man. No, I...
Oh, you know what? He did it for style points. He made that cannon at 420.
Oh, nice. Dude, it's funny trying to follow these builds Mini's doing. Mm-hmm. You know, he really... I almost think this is like... His nickname should be like the Cheater Protoss or something with what he's able to just pull off.
Mm-hmm.
We have 22 years of Protosses being terrified of Zergs early on. And just trying to get their stuff to where it needs to be to then have Mini just get away with so much that it's insane.
Can you imagine if you took Reach and sat him down and had him watch this game?
Yeah.
He wouldn't even know what... He's like, is this StarCraft 2?
No, we get Reach, we put him in a Clockwork Orange chair and open his eyes up and make him watch this. He's just screaming.
Yeah. For those of you who don't know, Reach was like... At the darkest time of Protoss, he was the best in the world.
In the Jurassic period of StarCraft, he was the best.
There was literally a Star League season where in the top 16 there was one Protoss and it was Reach.
Reach is just screaming and he's saying this is the worst build ever, and then we whisper in his ear, this guy won season 11 of ASL. He's like, no!
It's not as if he's dead or something. I mean, he could watch the match.
If you knew English, you could listen to this cast right now. But wait,
double robo?
What?
Of course, double robo.
I feel like Mini has built his meter up enough with the weird Protoss build that this is like his ultimate.
Yeah. Dude, okay, so
he picked the double Robo special for his ultimate and his fighting game character.
Can we go over the build for a second here?
Yes.
Nexus first, Gate Gas Core, Stargate Cannon, double Robo.
Oh, showed it. That was embarrassing.
Double Robo. He's got one cannon. This is wild what we're watching here. Now he lets some zealots off at some funny location here to try to walk around everything. The Ling's all coming back. He kind of assumes that there's a drop on the way.
I'm sorry, is there a spire making? We spent so much time looking at Protoss here.
I don't know. I don't think so.
The thing is, if there's no spire and this is Speedlot Reaver, I mean, I don't think Zerg lives.
Yeah, to put it lightly. Speedlot Reaver is incredibly strong.
Yeah.
Okay, the Zalt's going to come up. I mean, there's enough Hydras here that he doesn't really want to fight that right now.
Now, I don't know if we're going to get to check here. It just depends on what the Observer clicks on. But I do want to point out, he may end up getting, well, obviously Shuttle Speed, but maybe Scarab Damage.
We have seen that just every now and then against
Zerg. Every now and then, yeah. It's, I don't know. I mean, I could probably just go open up a, you know, campaign mode, just like a custom game, and like mess around with it. I don't know how much that impacts splash damage versus Hydras. Hydras die to one direct shot from a Scarab, but I don't know how the Scarab damage upgrade impacts the splash radius.
Works, yeah.
Ah!
Ooh. That would have been disastrous for Mini.
Mini would have just had a flashback of losing that shuttle in the other other game.
All right, he drops off the Reavers here. Getting a bit of damage. Zots. Look at this. He's trying to get that shuttle.
I'm sorry. How many Reavers are in this game? Does he just have two shuttles? Is that what he does? It's like one shuttle to stun double?
That's a good question, yeah. Oh, looks like he had a couple more Zealots. Yeah, he had more Zealots in there as well. Okay, well, he is actually wrecking face with these Reavers right now.
Oh, my God.
Dude, he's getting some serious shots off here.
Yeah, well, the thing is especially when Speed's done here, there's just so much to interfere with. He's got to be careful. Two Reavers is better than one. He's going to have to reload the Reavers.
Okay, going back. He has... I mean, he's got good production going now. What's he got? Four gates, adding some more.
I'm sorry, this is five hatch, and there's no spire, right?
I believe that is correct.
The thing is, he needs the Zealots to come up here.
Mm-hmm.
Gosh, did he miss that charge upgrade?
He got the Citadel like kind of late. He was so busy, you know, with the.
I just feel like
Robo.
It should be done by now. I don't want to be too nitpicky, but.
He's the greediest player ever. If it could have been done, it would have been done. There it is. And look at this. Like, is he going to be able to just kill him?
Oh, my God. He lost the shuttle. I mean, the Reavers can still be kept alive.
Well, now that the Reavers can't go home, maybe Larva has sealed his own death warrant by killing that shuttle.
You're trapped in here with me. So he's going to get more Zealots to come up. Plus one's done. Speed's done, which is a very big deal. Again, this was double Robo. I believe he's been producing the whole time. Is that correct? He basically has a foothold outside this area.
Mm-hmm.
And with enough mounted pressure, I don't know that Zerg can really, finesse a win here.
Four Reavers now.
Now, keep in mind, Reavers are a little bit stupid when it comes to firing uphill, but apparently not Minis.
No, he's doing a great job connecting with that sunk, and the speed lots get on top of absolutely everything. Shuttle's starting to juggle a little bit, but does he even need it? It seems like his Zealots can almost do it on their own. And with those four Reavers, he is starting to break through.
Is there no spire here?
I just feel like we do not have a spire.
All right, he's going to have to keep these. Okay, that's the injured shuttle, by the way, too. He's going to go for a drop at the main. No.
Turns back around. Wants that drone damage.
Oh, my God.
Some good shots off here onto those Hydras.
Good save. The damage is still coming. I just don't know that Larva can actually stabilize from all this.
No, Larva's got almost no supply left. It's 36 supply.
Oh,
GG,
my God.
We're going to game seven.
Game seven, baby.
All right. Ooh. Mini very happy with himself there. Cutting every corner.
He cut so many corners, it became a circle.
Became a sphere.
Oh, my God. It went 3D.
It went 3D.
It became Da Vinci's perfect circle.
Yes. Larva has to, I mean, he has to be thinking about that game like, wow, if I had done anything aggressive, you're dead.
He's like, oh, that's too bad that I went Hydras and you went double Robo Reaver with speed lots.
Yeah.
The one game I don't go Mutas.
Quite the build.
Yeah.
And you know what we
were
laughing?
He's like, too bad I went for fire when you went for water, huh?
Just matters how much fire you have, Tasteless. The sun could boil all of our oceans, okay? Okay, so we laughed about it at the beginning. What if we go to Game 7 and decide this on Fighting Spirit? Well, that is right. What is going to happen.
Getting the DeLorean. We're going back in time to Fighting Spirit. Mini.
You mean Biff.
Biff.
Biff here,
yeah, right.
With his almanac.
With his
he knows all
almanac.
The builds.
He's got his esports almanac.
Yeah.
Oh, it's funny.
He knows every single PVZ build
Biff
for the next 200 years.
With Liquipedia knew all the builds.
And this is it. For all the marbles, we are going to Fighting Spirit. I can't believe we get a Game 7. This is wonderful.
And, I mean,
we've had so many one-sided finals in ASL.
Oh, yeah. No, a lot of times we get so hyped for the finals, then when it's done, it's like, it's too bad it was 4-1, huh?
Yeah.
That's
it's like Flash and Queen speedrun people. It's
yeah.
It's really
yeah.
tough.
I'm like, I guess we really got to know how much better Queen was than his opponent because it was first to four wins.
Yeah.
Emotions so tense here with everybody. I mean, this is just such a back and forth. What a great fight these two have. Both of these guys on the cutting edge of the matchup. We're having games that just do not look like normal PVZs. And it's going to come down to a map that has literally been the most played map of the game.
Yes. Fighting Spirit. And let's not forget, there's some other things going on in this map. It's very close. If you're horizontal or vertical spawns, you are very close to your opponent.
That's true.
That can make things like the Zealot pressure a lot stronger. Also, those third bases, quite turtleable. Larva's style of taking another natural, very doable here. I don't know what to expect in this final map.
You could also center gate.
My God, if he goes double center gate.
I don't think he will.
Well, he's a real champion if he does.
I don't think he will.
It's time for him to double center gate. You sold me on it.
One base on this map too.
Yeah.
He's got a very tiny ramp.
That's true.
I've seen many do that before on this map. I don't know. I don't think he will. I think he's going to do what he's already done before.
Mm-hmm.
Again, that last game cannot be recreated because of the maps we're on. So we just got to wait.
Yes.
And see what happens here. But you don't really. It won't be double Robo again. That's an ultimate stream map.
Yes.
Guys, this is it, man. It's coming down to the final game. Game 7 on Fighting Spirits. Mini versus Larva is going to be settled right here, right now.
We have Mini in the bottom left. Larva in the top left. Dude, I can't believe the amount of pressure that must be on these two right now. It's been such a close series, and like all the victories have been blowouts as well.
Yeah.
There hasn't
yeah.
really been anything close. So it's like, oh my God. Hey, you know, winning a Star League is the ultimate dream of any StarCraft player.
Yeah, I mean, think of how long this game's been out, how long these guys have played, more than half their lives. And it's all going to come down to a center gate.
Oh, my God.
God.
It's going to be center two gate. It's going to be center two
gate.
Yeah,
of course. There is no center one gate, Artosis.
Oh, good.
Yeah.
Okay, only against Saren. Yeah. No, the center two gate, he has done this a ton, but not this season. We
right.
have seen him do this many, many times in ASL over the years. And Larva, oh, he does go pool. This is a 9-pool. How does 9-pool match up against this?
Well, the problem is that I mean, if he's going to get a pool that fast, I think he might want to get these links. Okay, this.
Just
oh,
extractor
God, this,
trick,
this...
maybe?
No, no, no. Oh, no, no. Okay, yeah. Yes. Yeah, yeah, no, no. Yeah, no, no. Yeah, no. I was going to say, if it's 9-pool speed, then we have a very weird game on our hands. But it's not.
Yeah,
it's
yeah. Not. Just straight up 9-pool.
Couple God. Things. We don't know how many lings are going to be made. Right?
Mm-hmm.
You can always throw a hatch out here. With the 9-pool, no, no, let's keep in
I
mind.
I mean, he'll probably make... He's going to make 6 lings, I think.
A lot of times you send those lings out to try to catch the guy who's going forward your Nexus quick.
Uh-huh.
Because they might not be prepared. The weird thing is... Okay, I might be wrong. I think Mini dies. I think on paper, Mini loses if Larva gets a sun.
Yeah. Okay, he gets in there, sees no probes making, a pylon being made. He knows what's up. Down goes the creep colony, but I don't feel like this is 100% auto lose.
It's not over, but now Mini is in a much more complicated, problematic position.
Yeah.
The lings are going to go by. Now, if he can get one zealot down here to help.
Oh, my God. Those lings going to the main base, Tasteless.
He's going to make a hatch here, too, so he can just counterattack. I think Larva has basically... taken.
I think
this.
You're right.
He's playing perfectly. He's got enough lings to hold this. There's a sunk here.
Oh, Mini is unhappy, and he is not going to like what he sees here with the Zerglings getting up into the probe line. Some good micro so far. Let's see what he can do defensively. There are Zots on their way back here to help, but he is taking some big damage on some of these probes.
Now, again, the decision tree for both sides gets really, really complicated here. Like, it's really, there's a lot. And by the way, he actually killed off way more lings than I think Larva
yeah.
should have let. I think Larva kind of did a little bit too much set and forget back there. And with one zealot here, I mean, God, there's so much to unpack here. Okay, first of all, this one zealot and the probes can actually take on these lings, okay? And there's more probes for Protoss than there are drones for the Zerg.
God, yeah, look at this. He's running around, targeting down probes as best he can. Some very good micro from Mini. Like, he is pulling a lot of them back, but that is a huge amount of damage.
Okay, so...
7 drones against 7 probes.
Okay, so that's very good for Larva, but there's a couple of other factors. A, that ramp's blocked. B, the other ramp can be blocked. C, we need to know, can Mini find the hidden hatch? You know there's a hidden hatch right now.
Okay.
You never think... I mean, first of all, if you are on one base, you've already won the game then. Very good control.
The drill, but he targets beautifully. Being as efficient as possible. A couple more zealots coming up to join these two on the ramp. Is Mini going to be able to hold on here?
This is still possible for the Protoss to win. But again, the threat of the counterattacks once Ling's speed is done is a nightmare. Also, Mini needs to get a forge now and make a cannon in his main. He should know that there's a real threat of this. I'm surprised he didn't send one probe out. I guess he doesn't have... that many probes.
Yeah,
with.
Only 7 probes makes
but
sense
he,
in a way.
He needs to scout this. There is no gasping mind.
Mm-hmm.
This is an extremely scrappy game.
He's going to check. Zealot's going to 6. That's a pylon.
Oh my God. He only has probes at this base. And I think there's going to be as many links as there are. No, actually, there's only 4. I'm sorry. I thought there were 6 links here.
Now, what is the play here? Does Mini need to get the forge and a cannon?
Eventually, yeah.
It's just like, but there are 2 hatches. If he starts canning his main, is that a clear victory?
No. This is one of the reasons why I think this actually became less popular now is because it gets so complicated on both sides. Mm. So again, it's not over. Protoss is controlling pretty well. He needs to fight these lings. He needs to get the zealot back over here.
This is absolute madness. Larva's micro so strong, and now Zergling speed is done. The probe's really getting blown up. Only 5 left over right now. Catches some of those lings.
Okay, he's going to go for the pylon, but Mini does have links over here. He gets pretty tough for the Protoss. He has to defend so many locations. But he needs to get this cannon up. And the problem is the probe count keeps getting reset to the point where I just don't know that he's going to be able to stabilize. I think Larva's going to get control of the low ground, and then he can take out the pylon. And from there, I think it's unwinnable for Protoss.
It is really looking that way. All these zods
are
being cleaned out.
You can see Mini's sort of processing the loss. And I'll tell you, man, there's always a little bit of degeneracy when you choose to two-gate like this. You got to wonder if this was the right call.
Well.
If it would have been better to, you know, maybe try to play a normal game.
Can't play sheepishly, that's for sure. Mikron as best he can with his remaining Zealots here. Almost no probes at home.
Oh, look
at Mini. His hands off. And that is going to be that. Larva, the ASL Season 11 champion.
Unbelievable. He's done it. He's been grinding for so long, and now he is on top of the world. Larva is your ASL champion.
An amazing run from Larva as well. He took down Rush in the round of eight, who's considered the best or second best Terran in the world right now. Then he took down Hero, a formidable ASL finalist Zerg. And now in the finals, he took down the best Protoss player out there against Zerg in Mini. He ran the gamut and came out on top.
And you can see the emotions here with Larva. I mean, how often are you ever going to get a chance to win an ASL? Flash is gone, which makes it a little bit more doable. He was, I think, like a lot of other people, I mean, us included, we did not expect him to be a strong contender for this when we saw the final eight. We almost thought of him as a bit of a novelty to be in the top eight. Then he got to the top four. That was pretty crazy. But now he got to the finals. Clearly, he's a master of ZVP because Mini beat Queen, the two-time ASL champion. Quick interview, guys. Let's see how Larva is feeling now that he's won Season 11 of the ASL.
결승 무대에 올라갔는데 항상 8강, 4강에서 떨어지면서 나는 우승자가 아닌가, 우승자와 거리가 먼 사람인가 그런 고민에 빠졌던 이몽규 선수가 이제 드디어 우승을 차지하게 됐습니다. 이번 우승을 차지한 이몽규 선수와 이야기를 나눠보도록 하겠습니다. 자, 이쪽으로 좀 자리해 주시고요. ASL의 역사 시즌1을 시작으로 이번 시즌까지 정말 힘들게 싸워서 우승을 만들어냈습니다. 2010년 팀에 들어가서 제대로 출격기회도 얻지 못하고 선수들 연습 파트너로 연습을 하다가 또 개인방송 아프리카TV에 와서 계속 꿈만 꾸다가 AS에 도전장을 내밀었거든요. 11년 그 역사에 드디어 정점을 찍는 이 순간이 왔습니다. 남들과는 좀 다른 우승일 텐데요. 어떠세요?
일단은 믿기지가 않아요. 제가 게임하면서도 약간 꿈꾸고 있나 약간 이런 생각하면서 계속 게임을 했었는데 일단 모르겠어요. 감정이 좀 오묘하네요. 좀 그동안에 게임했던 것들이 좀 생각나기도 하고 만감이 교차한 것 같아요. 뭐라고 해야 될지 모르겠습니다.
이 스타 ASL 또 이 멋진 무대에서 오늘 수십만 명의 시청자분들이 지켜봐 주셨고 이몽규 선수의 우승하는 장면을 꾸준히 지켜보셨거든요. 끝까지 포기하지 않고 많은 연습량을 소화하면서 이렇게 우승까지 차지했고 그러려면 힘든 순간들이 굉장히 좀 많았을 텐데 우승을 차지하게 됐습니다. 무엇보다도 뭐 가족분들 그리고 정말 10수년간 좀 사랑해준 팬분들 많이 생각이 날 텐데요. 네. 오반 분들에게 마음껏 네. 이야기할 수 있는 시간을 드리겠습니다.
일단 정말 뭐 제가 8강에서도 얘기했지만 정말 이렇게 연습하고 떨어지면 정말 세상이 불공평하지 않을까라고 생각을 하면서 이번 결승도 준비를 했었거든요. 그래서 오후 2시에는 뭐 도재욱 선수 그리고 또 오후 6시나 뭐 8시쯤에는 이제 장윤채 선수, 저녁 12시에는 김태경 선수 그리고 또 보충 연습으로 이제 병구 형님과 이제 송병구 선수와 그리고 또 원선재 선수까지 진짜 많은 토스들과 좀 게임을 하면서 자신감에 차 있었는데 오늘 호락호락하지 않았던 것 같아요. 정말 어렵게 이겨가지고 연습을 더 열심히 해야겠다라고 생각이 들었고 그리고 또 옆에서 와이프가 많이 이렇게 내조도 해주고 정말 힘 많이 써줬는데 너무 고맙다라고 전하고 싶고 예, 그래도 차제들도 고맙고요. 예. 예. 아, 그래도 모르겠습니다. 다 고마워요. 예.
팬분들 정말 예, 여기서 뭐 하나 정말 예, 멋진 장면 나올 때마다 막 정말 내일같이 응원해 주신 그 수많은 팬분들 수천 수만 분의 팬분들이 계셨기 때문에 또 지금 이몽규가 탄생된 거 아닙니까? 그분들에게도
아, 일단은 정말 연락이 많이 왔었어요. 연락이 팬분들하고 뭐 시청자분들하고 알고 지냈던 지인분들도 많았었는데 진짜 감정에 좀 휘말리기 싫어서 일부러 카톡도 안 보고 계속 3일 동안 게임을 했었어요. 그래서 이 자리를 빌어서 또 앞으로 이제 갚아 나갈 테니까 응원해 주신 만큼 또 갚아 나갈 테니까 많이 응원해 주셨으면 좋겠고 사랑해 주셨으면 좋겠습니다.
이제 어깨가 좀 많이 무거워질 텐데 이제는 우승자 출신으로서 경기를 좀 이어나가야 되거든요. 앞으로 있을 ASL, 앞으로 있을 리그들에서 어떤 모습 보여줄지 각오 한 말씀도 해주시죠.
매번 ASL 경기를 볼 때마다 시드자들이나 뭐 우승자들 볼 때마다 좀 쉬운 상대들을 좀 많이 골랐던 것 같아요. 하지만 저는 좀 다르게 오히려 더 강한 선수들을 좀 선택하면서 정말 우승자가 뭔지 보여드릴 테니까 예, 기대해 주셨으면 좋겠습니다.
그리고 끝으로 정말 이몽규 선수에게 좀 중계진을 대표해서 감사하다는 말씀 드리겠습니다. ASL이 이렇게 수많은 팬분들의 사랑을 받고 이 멋진 무대가 만들어지고 거기다 힘이 실리는 데는 지금까지 이렇게 많은 노력을 해준 선수분들이 있었기 때문에 좀 이렇게 더 많은 사랑을 받지 않나 그런 생각이 좀 들거든요. 앞으로도 멋진 모습 그리고 팬분들에게 감동을 선사하는 그런 모습 부탁드리도록 하겠습니다. 다시 한번 감사드립니다. 네. 자 그럼 자리해 주시고 이제 시상식을 진행하도록 하겠습니다. ASL 시즌 11 하식스와 LG 울트라기어와 함께하고 있습니다. 이번 시즌 유독 멋진 경기들이 많이 나왔거든요. 그리고 결승 무대까지도 선수들이 정말 많은 시간, 수천 시간 준비하면서 이런 멋진 드라마를 만들어냈습니다. 다시 한번 ASL에 참가하고 최선을 다해준 선수들에게 감사드릴 말씀을 여기서 드리도록 하겠습니다. 자 먼저 준우승 부분의 시상이 있겠습니다. 이번 시즌 시상에는요 아프리카TV e스포츠 게임 콘텐츠 사업 부분의 최정원 부분장직께서 수고를 해주시겠습니다. 자 무대로 모시도록 하겠습니다. 아 이제 프로게이머 좀 선배로서 또 이렇게 이몽규 선수가 이 바닥부터 시작을 해서 최정상까지 올라가는 모습 지켜보셨는데요 선배로서 한 말씀 부탁드리도록 하겠습니다.
프로게이머를 한 지 이제 너무 오래됐으니까 사실은 프로게이머 짧게 이제 너무 오래됐는데 그 선수들이 ASL 진행하면서 벌써 11번째 시즌이 됐고 그 새로운 스토리가 계속해서 이 ASL 내에서도 다시 계속해서 쓰여진다는 생각이 들어서 그게 정말 기쁘고요. 이렇게 새로운 스토리를 만들어준 우리 BJ분들 선수분들에게 너무 감사하고 또 제작진분들이 이렇게 잘 만들어주셨고 중계진분들 그리고 함께 응원해주시는 우리 유저 여러분들 계속해서 ASL이 이런 새로운 스토리를 만들어갈 수 있도록 많은 응원 그리고 많은 저희들도 노력 많이 하도록 하겠습니다. 감사합니다.
ASL 시즌 11 이 최고의 강세를 뚫고 결승 무대까지 올라와서 마지막 세트까지 최선을 다해준 준우승자를 호명해 보도록 하겠습니다. 불러보겠습니다. 미니 변현재. 정말 멋진 활약. 이 변현재의 프로토스의 신드롬을 좀 보여주면서요 이번 결승 무대까지 올라왔습니다. 정말 아쉽게 한 끗 차이로 패배를 했습니다만 다음 시즌이 더욱더 기대가 되는 선수죠. 변현재 선수에게도 많은 노력 다시 한번 감사하다는 말씀을 드리겠습니다. 앞으로도 멋진 활약, 팬분들의 감동을 선사하는 선수가 되어주시길 부탁드리겠습니다. 다시 한번 감사드리고요. 그리고 실상을 도와주신 최정은 부문장님께도 다시 한번 깊은 감사의 말씀을 드리겠습니다. 고맙습니다. 네, 고맙습니다. 이어서 우승 시상이 있겠습니다. ASL이 만들어지고 또 이 선수들에게 꿈의 무대를 선사해주신 정말 고마우신 분이시죠. 아프리카TV 서수길 대표이사님을 무대로 모시도록 하겠습니다. 대표님을 모셔서 이야기를 나눠보는 시간을 갖도록 하겠습니다. 대표님, 그 어느 때보다도 오늘 뜻깊고 그리고 정말 이 아프리카 개인 방송을 시작으로 해서 이 선수가 발전해서 우승까지 차지하는 모습을 직접 현장에서 지켜보셨거든요. 한 말씀 부탁드리겠습니다.
우선 이렇게 현장에 저는 있었는데 우리 스타팬 우리 유저분들과 같이 경기장에 못 있다는 게 우선 제일 마음이 아프고 빨리 상황이 좋아져서 우리 경기장에 같이 모여서 응원했으면 좋겠습니다. 우리 하이미 아빠 정말 너무 이번 시즌 놀라울 정도의 기세와 실력으로 올라와서 경기 중에도 제가 너무 놀랬고 정말 축하하고 변현재 선수도 야, 그 표정 가지고 끝까지 이기고 올라오는 게 너무 대단했는데 오늘 명경기를 펼쳐준 우리 두 선수한테 너무 고맙습니다. 그리고 다시 한번 우리 ASL이 시즌 11 또 계속 가능하게 해준 에너지 드링크 핫6 LG 울트라 기어 게이밍 모니터 여러분 사랑해 주시고 또 뒤에 있는 또 멸망전 또 계속된 대회 다음 ASL도 여러분 계속 많은 응원과 사랑 후원 부탁드리겠습니다. 감사합니다.
다시 한번 감사드립니다. 고맙습니다. 핫6와 LG 울트라 기어가 함께한 ASL 시즌 11 대망의 우승자를 불러보도록 하겠습니다. 인간 승리 드라마를 만들어내면서 11년 만에 우승을 차지한 선수죠. 불러보겠습니다. 라바 이몽큐! 정말 많은 노력을 하면서 이 무대에 올라왔습니다. 처음으로 진출한 결승 무대에서 강력한 프로토스 변현재 선수를 잡아내면서 드디어 우승을 차지하게 됐습니다. 우승을 차지한 이몽규 선수에게는 3천만 원의 상금이 주어지겠습니다. 다시 한번 멋진 감동의 드라마를 선사한 이몽규 선수에게 감사하다는 말씀을 드리겠습니다. 앞으로도 더 멋진 활약, 더 멋진 경기를 보여주면서 많은 팬분들 가슴 속에 감동을 선사하는 선수로 자리매김하길 바라겠습니다. 다시 한번 감사드리고요. 꾸준히 ASL을 이어질 수 있도록 많은 도움을 주고 계신 서수규 대표님께도 다시 한번 깊은 감사의 말씀 드리겠습니다. 고맙습니다, 대표님. 그리고 항상 노력해준 이몽규 선수에게도 다시 한번 감사의 말씀을 드리겠습니다. 자, 이렇게 이번 시즌의 모든 경기 마무리가 됐습니다. 이번 시즌은 유도 최선을 다하는 경기들 그리고 역대급 경기들이 나왔다는 말씀을 좀 드리고요. 앞으로도 이 선수들의 노력은 계속될 거라고 생각을 합니다. 이 좋은 무대, 멋진 경기에 수많은 팬분들을 모시고 함께할 수 있는 그런 시간을 마련하고 싶었는데요. 그게 잘 안 돼서 다시 한번 죄송하다는 말씀을 드리고요. 그리고 이렇게 멋진 무대에서 선수들이 최선을 다하는 경기를 펼칠 수 있도록 항상 고민하고 노력한 제작진 그리고 이 선수들의 땀방울까지 담기 위해서 또 마지막까지 최선을 다해준 카메라팀 그리고 연출팀 여러 팀들에게 감사해야 한다는 말씀을 드리겠습니다. 자, 저희는 여기서 인사드리고요. 이제 곧 펼쳐질 스톰 멸망전 그리고 스타팀 리그로 돌아올 것을 약속드리면서 전이 물러가도록 하겠습니다. 마지막에 주인공은 바로 이몽규 선수죠. 이몽규 선수의 트로피 세레머니로 막을 내리도록 하겠습니다. 함께해 주신 여러분 진심으로 고맙습니다.
Guys, thank you again for joining us for this ASL Finals. We are going to have that King of the Hill match coming up. Check out our Patreon at patreon.com/ASL English for more information.
That's right, guys. Thank you so much again for supporting the ASL. We will be back with more. And congratulations to Larva for his first championship victory.
strong.